What's happening, guys? It's Adam here. Just before we go into this week's episode, I want to let you know that we do an extra episode of this shit every single week exclusively on Patreon. If you don't know what Patreon is, it's basically a way for you to financially support this podcast while getting a few rewards for yourself. Now, you can sign up for £3 a month, £5 a month, or £10 a month. The more money you give us, the more benefits you get. But even the people who only sign up for £3 a month, which is what, less than the price of a fancy coffee, you get an extra episode every single week, which is about an hour and a half long, where it's just me and Dan most of the time. You also get early access to these public episodes with the guests. You get discounts on merch, discounts on live shows, early access to tickets for stuff like that. And also, you get access to every single Patreon episode we've already done as soon as you sign up. There's a shitload of stuff there. It's a massive back catalogue. We've been doing this for months now. Sign up today at patreon.com/haveawordpod. The link is in the description. Subscribe to this channel while you're there. Give us a little like on the video and let's get to the podcast. Oh no. Not acceptable. Not on this podcast.
That is not how you start a podcast.
Welcome to the show.
First time watchers and listeners are going, what is this? Very good. Just, you're safe here. Come on. It's
That's
a safe space.
Not necessarily
space.
True.
Not really.
How are you?
Dead good. Yeah, really good. I came out without any money. That's any money or any bank cards. So thank fuck.
Do you not have...
You're cashed up.
Do you not have to pay on your phone? Are you you're not an Apple, are you?
I'm not. I think you can do it, but I'm 108 mentally. And that takes a lot.
I don't trust it.
And, I can't pay. You can't pay with a watch.
I don't pay for anything not on my phone anymore. And it's great because, like, well, it's a blessing and a curse. It feels like you're not paying for it.
Tip tap.
You're just like, oh, wave me phone over there. Like, there's no way when I wave me phone over there, like yesterday in the range when I bought like loads of stuff to do my house up with and I just waved me phone and it was 324 quid. There's no way that took 324 quid out of my bank. It was free.
Yeah.
Some of it was free.
If you have to count it out. Was it?
I'm a little bit pinchy.
One for me, one for me, one for range. Fuck you.
Should I tell you my little?
Go on.
So any long-time listeners who listen during lockdown will know, I like a little bit of a steal. I don't need to steal. I treat it as a game. And it starts at very low level. My rules with me stealing game is I normally do it in a service station. And I'll go, sorry if you've heard this before, but I'll go to the till. And I'll have like a can of Coke, a packet of crisps, and a notebook. And I'll put the Coke and the crisps on the till. And I'll hold the notebook. And if the woman in the WH Smiths in the service station goes, is that notebook from here? I make sure she sees it. And if she goes, is that from here? Then I go, oh yeah, I'm really sorry. And I've lost the game. But if she doesn't say anything, I just walk out with the notebook.
Stealing in plain sight.
Yeah. And yesterday,
you've got a notebook in your underpants. That looks bad, doesn't it?
Yeah. Wait,
if you've jammed it up somewhere,
yeah,
that's
fucking stupid stealing. It just looks like I'll be on my phone or something and pretend like I'm so sorry. Yeah, that's from here too. I'm always doing that. I'm really sorry.
I nicked a wallet from TK Maxx the exact same way.
Yes.
Had the wallet in my hand, the fucking bank card there, paid for some other shit, and she was just like, hey, on you go.
Yeah, that's your wallet.
Fucking loved it.
Well, yesterday I stole two curtain poles and a rake.
What?
Two curtain poles
how
and a rake.
Mate, whoever is working in the range yesterday and saw him load up the fucking from the trolley, holding a rake and like, oh yeah, these are my curtain rails and rake. I just carried them. Fucking hell. That's honestly not concentrating, is it? How did you do it?
Because players gon' play and haters gon' hate.
But how can you...
Smashed it?
Mate, are you sure it wasn't one of them, you know, like... Who's it not all right to steal off? You know, when you're at Sainsbury's or the range or fucking Home and Bargain.
No, she wasn't one of them.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm pretty sure. What?
Okay, good.
I'm pretty sure she was a manager.
Oh,
man. I'm
mate.
Pretty sure because she had a slightly different outfit on.
Down. Oh, fuck her then.
Slightly different outfit on from everyone else. You know, when you're like, you're the captain, you. She's either the manager or the goalkeeper.
She's in a position where she should know that a fucking rake and some curtain poles is not like.
Here's what I did, right? So
he was like, hit them in my eyeballs.
I was on my own. If Carl was with me, I'd have got two trolleys yesterday because I got that much stuff. I got like two lots of new bedding. I got two sets of curtains, one for the patio bit, one for me front.
He's sorting out your life, babe.
I got loads of cushions.
He's got new clothes, and then he went out drinking, and that's over now. The part of the regeneration of Adam Rowe is now at home. He's getting plants. I just want to change the decor.
I do want to change the decor because she's gone now, and I can make it look exactly how I want it to look.
Oh, the fucking dream.
Oh, I've never had this like control over a house, though, because I've always lived. I lived in my dad's, then I lived in my auntie's, and I got no say on how anything was decorated. Then yeah, I moved in with Danny really McLaughlin, and he was like, we're not fucking decorating. Fuck that. And then I moved back in with my dad, then I moved in with me ex. And I, because I was away so often and she'd moved from out of Liverpool to into Liverpool to live with me, I was just trying to be sound. I was like, you can decorate the house however you want, babe. You make it look however you want. And I've got a fucking yellow bedroom. It's a fucking nightmare. But now...
And that literally happened 4 weeks before the end of lockdown as well, didn't it?
Yeah.
It's not like that's not from even 3 years ago. Yeah.
It's dead annoying. But like now, I'm trying, like, I'm going, like, in the living room, I'm going for like a charcoal wall. I'm going dark grey. I'm going like subtle lighting to just pop it up. I'm making it look like a little man sex dungeon, right?
That was really like
chains on the walls.
The young grown up until right at the end, you know. I want it to really, really offset each other and just be a lovely like a mood lighting so I can crack one out on watching my 50-inch TV.
I'm gonna fuck a woman.
In the lounge?
Yeah.
Right.
When you start dating someone, you try and fuck them in every room, don't you? Try and complete your house. That cupboard under the stairs is always the last one to do, but...
I just feel like...
You must have shagged your missus in every room in your house.
Well, who's...
No, because it's not my house, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Be respectful.
In her house.
In her house, yeah.
Be respectful.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's a ball ache eventually when you're like, right, two to do, pantry, conservatory. You know, you're like, oh, there's not even fucking curtains in the...
Garden as well.
In the conservatory.
Got a garage and it leaks. That's a nice little effect, isn't it?
The garage.
You finished? No, that's the roof.
Oh, fuck, I love banging you here. I can read the gas meter. Yeah.
Oh, I put the heating on the other night for the first time.
Oh, right,
babe. Oh, my God. You when I fucking come round then?
It's flabs, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm playing PlayStation with him and my hands are like fucking ice.
Yeah.
I fucking hate it. This is, just be aware of this, when people can't work their own thermostat. Work out what is a normal human fucking temperature.
Oh, so I don't know how to do that. What I do is I just turn the heating on and then it does what it does.
Right. Hang
it's
on.
It's either on or it's off.
Oh, my God.
Or it's on.
God.
See, I hate
or
the
it's
heating.
Off.
I'd rather get in bed.
Yeah, but my house is just a bit chilly, innit?
Yeah, downstairs.
No, I get it. You can't have the heating on when you're in bed. Get a proper duvet. Mm-hmm. Put some fucking socks
on. Got a new
on.
Duvet. Got two.
But when people can't do the fucking temperature... You knew Matt around your mate's house going, this isn't fun. Why is it freezing?
Yes.
We've got a mate, Laura and her sister have got a mate called Kerry, and she doesn't feel temperature. She's like, come round and I'll do dinner. And it's fucking Baltic, like late August. It's fucking cold in September. I'm not into it. So good, I like it. It's changing, isn't
it? So I got myself some pillows for the couch. I got some new, like big pillows for the bed, but I also got some like decorative pillows as well. Like that night, got a throw to match the pillows I got for the bed. Oh, got some charcoal bedding, got a new rug for the living room, got some nice curtains.
Charlie charcoal?
Yeah. Oh, I'm going charcoal everywhere. The whole house is just going to be... No, the whole don't. House is going to look like this. Imagine the studio in the house.
Don't do that.
Boar. So the trolley was so full. Like normally, they're very like shallow tills at the range. So you know like when you do a big shop in Asda?
What do you mean shallow tills?
Right. You know when you do a big shop at Asda? And you get to the conveyor belt. And what you do is you empty your whole trolley onto the conveyor belt. And then you put your trolley at the end and it's now empty and you can start putting stuff back in.
Yes, mate.
Right. Well, at the range, there's no conveyor belt. It's just a little tiny bit. So I'm literally full of stuff. So what I was doing was just one by one, giving her stuff to scan. And then she'd put it to the end and then I started putting it back in the trolley. So she was just like trusting me to just give her everything that was in the trolley. And I just never gave her the curtain poles. I never gave her the rake. And then I just walked. Do do do. I do do do. I do 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 do.
Is that you stealing? Is that the stealing sound? Do 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 do. I'm a thieving fucker. Do do do.
We done the same in B&M, didn't we, last week?
He did, yeah.
We bought a bin. We bought two bins.
Put my new bedding in the bin.
I put the new bedding in the bin and gave her the bin to scan.
So, yeah, that's exactly what you should do.
Professional thief.
It's plausible deniability, isn't it? What were you like? You've got to be able to be believed when you go, oh, and this is where your acting skills come in. Like, no, if you just go, no, no. You're like, no, you can't act.
She didn't
do
her job.
Oh, madam, yeah. I am so sorry. Oh, it has been quite like the morning.
The curtain poles are fucking 300 centimetres long, so they're fucking, they're sticking out the trolley.
300 centimetres long.
They're literally, like, they're hanging out the trolley. Like, they're massive. So she should have gone, can I scan them, please? And she just didn't.
And this is a manager?
I think so.
Ah, fucking hell.
Yeah, so...
I mean, would you give a shit if you just worked there? You'd be like, I can't be fucking
each
bothered.
Curtain pole was 30 quid each, and the rake was 12 quid. So 72 quid in my back jacksie.
Good. Do you know this goes on the internet?
It does.
Yeah.
It's all for comedy
effect. What range was it?
It's just banter.
What range was it? Skem, wasn't it?
Skem range. Skem range. The skem range, yeah.
The skem range. you know, buying all this stuff, do you know what is happening politically? Have you just stopped checking your phone?
What do you mean?
Have you just gone, fuck it? You're just going into a shutdown with spending. Is that what you...
Yeah, well, I haven't even got it yet, but today I'm getting the money from my tour, which finished in March.
Right, okay, good.
So I've got a bit of money that I need to do my house up, because at the minute, it looks like a couple's house that the man let the woman decorate.
Yeah.
And I don't want it to look like
a house. I know what you mean, yeah.
And I just want it to look a bit more me. I need to start living my truth, and I'm not going to be able to do that until I decorate it.
Do you know what I mean? It's amazing.
I just want it to be
I think you're the only comic in the country who this weekend is like, right, off to the range, let's fucking decorate. Every comic's going, fucking hell, there's going to be no gigs. Everyone's shitting it collectively. And me and you are like, we've got a fucking hit YouTube show.
I'm going to carry on gigging, and I've said this 100 times. I'm not stopping gigging. I will just call them protests, and you can't, by international law, stop someone peacefully protesting. I'm going to protest through the medium of stand-up comedy, whether that's indoor or outdoors. It's fucking happening. The gigs will be happening. They'll be advertised on here, on my Twitter, me Instagram. Hey. Boris Johnson, Matt Hancock, and Rishi Sunak can suck my average-sized pipe.
Honestly, I tell you what, when he's got this whole house decorated, then he's taking down the government. He's going to have charcoal here, charcoal there. And then when that's finished, got some nice candles up, do you know what I mean? Some potpourri. Then I'm going to fuck up the Tory government. But the thing they can do is take the licenses away. Mate, I'm just devil's advocate in here.
What, they're going to take my licence away from having gigs in my back garden?
Easy, cheap.
I'll do it in my back garden.
You've got to sort your garden first. Get some nice charcoal. Get a charcoal lawn. Just a charcoal wall. Charcoal flowers. Charcoal audience. This is my worry about this whole call to arms. Mate, I'll take the gigs. I'll be there. But I'm not fucking running them because that's a different fine. What I feel so much for licensed premises that if they're about to shut them down
I'm
for
not
3 weeks,
expecting licensed premises to risk anything for me.
We got offered the paint factory, didn't we?
We did. I've got it up. Do you want me to read it? I have got it up. We got Kirsty McNeil.
Yes.
You fucking legend. She was like, OMG, if you need a venue, my husband has got a paint factory in Garston, and I'm sure the landlord would give you a room. And then she went, oh, fuck that. You could use the factory. He has loads of pallets to sit on. Pure gangster gig. I'd be a barmaid. Sound. That's from Kirsty McNeil. I'm not even joking. I'd be up for it.
Why have I not seen this?
Because it's on the email. It's on the email.
We're doing that next week. Next weekend, we're both not gigging, are we?
Saturday?
Next Saturday.
Are we?
Yeah.
So
Saturday the 17th.
Make it Sunday, so it's a secret Sunday.
No, it doesn't have to be a secret. I'm going to fucking ram it. I want 600 people there. It's a protest. It's a protest against the government's lack of support for the entertainment and hospitality industry.
It's a
protest.
Yeah, but you've got a promise. You've got to promise Kirsty and me and Carl not to nick any charcoal paint. Kirsty, it's high risk. Never mind COVID. Never mind fucking enforcement officers. He'll be coming out. Adam, your jacket looks massive. That's tough.
No, I don't do that. I'm not a pocketer. I only steal stuff when they can see it. I'm like Robin Hood.
Goodbye, Kirsty. Two tins of Dulux.
No, I am. Like, if I'm in there and there's two tins of Dulux and I pick them up and I'm like, right, I'm getting off in a minute. So,
Adam, have you got some of our paint? No, these are my weights. No, I can't have them everywhere.
You see, you haven't been listening to me. If she goes, are they our paint? I'll go, oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to pick them up. But if I'm like, whoa, paint, pain. Dulux, I've got some Dulux in my hands. Where did I get these from? If I do all that and she's still like, yeah, yeah, see you soon.
Genuinely, do you want to do it?
I'm not even messing. Right.
We're going to have to work out a way for people to find out where it is on the slizzles. Look, there's a way, isn't there?
We'll advertise. We'll talk to Kirsty in the break before the guest comes in today. Oh, I'm so excited. I can't say how excited.
There's going to be a back call on Twitter, and it'll be like coded, like Papa wants some charcoal. And when you hear Papa wants some charcoal, that means we've got deets for a gig. And the government will be like, oh, there's been a lot of movement around. Oh, we're worried about charcoal. Can't work out the code.
Look, let's just say this.
Just watch the
we'll get in touch with Kirsty today and try and get this arranged for next Saturday.
Where is it? Where's Garston?
It's South Liverpool.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. It's South Liverpool.
Love South Liverpool.
So, look out on my Twitter, the podcast Twitter, Dan's Twitter, on all our Instagrams. So my Twitter is Adam Rowe Comedy. My Instagram is Adam Rowe Comedian. Here's Dan has a podcast on both of them. The podcast is Have a Word Pod on all of them, and Sensei Carl as well, obviously. But if you are not really big on social media and you're not going to catch it there, just email us, haveawordpod@gmail.com. If you are near the Liverpool area and you want to come and see a stand-up gig next Saturday, whether or not the government... a protest. If you want to come to a protest through the medium of stand-up comedy next Saturday, you've just got to email us with the subject line, Papa wants some charcoal. And we will send you the ticket link and we will make this happen.
Mama, Papa like charcoal, like Papa like charcoal.
I'm doing it.
That's exciting, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. Oh, it's different feeling.
I want to not do any more podcast. I want to just go and arrange this gig.
Guys, this on, you know? We've only done a 15-minute episode. We've got shit to do. Are they actually going to shut us down here? Is this what? Are they about to tell us that all hospitality venues are closed down? Because it feels like this government do this sly thing, which is actually quite clever. They just sort of tell everyone without telling anyone. They sort of leak all their policies and then just sort of gauge the boot off.
Yeah.
And they're like, yeah, well, you know.
So we're recording this on Friday the 9th of October. It doesn't go out, obviously. It'll go on Patreon either tomorrow or Sunday, and then it goes public on Monday. I did Hot Water last night. So I did Hot Water Comedy Club last night. I'm there tonight and I'm there again tomorrow. Paul Smith was comparing Jack Carroll, who has done Britain's Got Talent and Live at the Apollo, opened the show, and I closed the show. Now, that's a profile bill. It's Paul Smith, it's me, and it's Jack Carroll. Like, the only one who's been on telly is not me or Paul Smith. Do you know what I mean? Like, he's done the big TV shows. There was 25 people in the audience, and there was, like, 80 or something booked, and most of them didn't turn up because they thought things were already shut. Because the amount of confusion and misinformation being leaked by this government and perpetuated by the media is A, scaring people, and B, it's making people go, it won't be open.
I know it can't be open.
Can't be open because everywhere's shut, isn't it? Isn't the whole thing shut?
It's so confusing to the point where the Prime Minister is so easily discombobulated. I know that happened anyway.
He can't
anyway,
even explain his but own
he
bastard
he has
rules.
No idea. In those interviews when he's like, someone tell me about Leeds. You're like, it's a fucking travesty, mate. If you're going to be cunts about it, at least be simple with your cuntery. Don't get fucking lost in a web of your own stupidity.
I don't think it's him. I think there's people behind him. Like, low.
No shit, mate. He's got the spider army behind him, hasn't he?
No, but I don't think he's even making any decisions.
No, he isn't. But the thing is, and we all know that, everyone knows that the Prime Minister doesn't make decisions. He has to listen to everyone around him who looks into it more. But he should be able to explain what these clear rules are. When a journalist is going, right, so you're not allowed to mix with other households, but can a mother meet her daughter in the park? They can't, but they can both go to the park separately. Like, all this ambiguity and all this fucking nonsense, it's his job to lead. It's not his job.
The Prime Minister, he's the figurehead.
Yeah, it's not necessarily his job to make decisions, but it's his job to be able to explain the decisions and explain the policy and explain the rules. He's a leader, or at least he's fucking supposed to be.
For now.
He's supposed to be able to go, watch what I do, look at what I'm doing and what I'm telling you to do, that's what you do. And then his fucking dad's walking around fucking Tesco with no mask on and everyone's like, wasn't your dad walking around Tesco? Oh, well, I can't control my father. Oh, but we've got it all controlled. Everyone in our lives. You're telling pubs they've got to control people, but you can't control anyone. It's
also masks and restrictions is great. stop closing businesses down, you fucking maniacs. Like, when they're like, well, children have obviously got to go to school and people have got to go to work. But even though they're the higher infection rates, they're literally traced back through science to be the cause of a lot of these infections. We've got to shut down the hospitality sector. Where's the fucking science behind these decisions?
Well, I've
crippling.
It's starting to get to, I stopped looking into stuff a few months ago because it was just driving me mad. I've looked into this. So basically, the reason they're shutting down the hospitality sector, as far as I can tell, again, if you're not a regular listener to this, don't take anything we say seriously. Don't take this as advice. This is two fucking idiots just spilling out their opinions that are ill-researched. However, as far as I can tell, they can't have both. So it's not that the hospitality sector is causing more infections than the schools are. But having both of them open is causing a problem. So they're going to shut the one that is easiest to shut.
That could be a perception.
It's
there's
necessity,
no,
isn't
there's
it?
No proof.
It's necessity. Yeah, totally.
There's literally no proof.
I'm not saying I agree with that, but that's their approach. So essentially, the hospitality sector might be causing 20% of these infections and the education sector is causing 80% of them. Let's say they're the numbers. What they're essentially saying is, well, if we just take that 20% away, the hospitals will be able to cope. So although the schools is causing more of a problem, we'd rather shut bars than we would shut schools. So that's why we're closing that.
It's so short-sighted economically. And I was like, come on, Tories. You don't give a fuck about people. You've never given a fuck about people. Don't pretend now you really give a fuck about people. But that the problem is with that, well, you can't shut schools. God forbid you shut schools temporarily. They're completely funded. Like, they will be there. Those institutions will be there. And obviously there is a knock-on effect on the education of children, but children are pretty, like, not flexible is not the right word. They can bounce back from change. Like, obviously you don't want schools shut for a whole year, but some businesses will not be there. Like, if you're talking about the long-lasting effects of a recession, shut things down that can't come back. Schools are publicly funded. They will come back. And, like, this is my big worry with shutting hospitality down. It'll be like, oh, it's a circuit breaker. We'll just do it for 2 weeks. Well, they only did the 10 p.m. curfew fucking recently. They cannot know yet if that has had, like, how can they know for sure in a week and a half if that's having a negative or positive effect? It's Where's because, the science backed up? So they'll shut us down for 2 or 3 weeks and then maybe go, oh, we need to just keep you shut down. What on a fucking whim?
We've sort of touched on this before. The last time it was fucking, are we going to open? Are we going to close? Or whatever. They can't do this. And they certainly, the hypocrisy of it, like at the minute, I think it's, look again, I haven't really looked, I haven't got the exact fucking figures, but I don't need them because I'm not running the fucking country. I host a podcast. I think Westminster has got a much higher, like the borough of Westminster, which is in central London, has got a much higher R rate and COVID rate than the Northwest. But that's staying open and the Northwest is shut. And it just, it leads into so many conspiracy theorists' ideas of like the managed decline that Margaret Thatcher wanted to put in place, I nearly spat on the floor then, of Liverpool back in the 80s when she was like, we should leave Liverpool to rot away. Just take their funding away. They're never going to vote for us anyway. It fucking stinks of it. It's, oh, well, we'll experiment with the North. Let's close all them down and see if that helps. And if it doesn't, if it does, then we'll put it in place down here. And if it doesn't, then we'll keep the economy going down here. I've got so many friends who work in the hospitality sector. I've got friends who own comedy clubs, obviously. One of my best mates is the owner of Hot Water Comedy Club. He's the most calm, collected, intelligent, ferocious businessman person I've ever met in my life. And I've never seen him and heard him sound so nervous as I have in the past few weeks because he's built a business up from literally fuck all, an open mic night on
from
a Sunday
nothing.
In a nightclub to a multi-million pound business. And he... Hot Water Comedy Club, compared to every other comedy club in the UK, bar and maybe the Comedy Store, is in the healthiest position. There's comedy clubs much more vulnerable than Hot Water. And I know for a fact, if this lockdown goes on for 6 months or whatever the prospective date was that he gave us a few weeks ago, hot water is at risk of not being there. So if they're not going to be there, the Frog and Bucket's not going to be there, Comedia might not be there, the Glee Clubs might not be there. There's so many, the industry will be wiped out. And if the government are going to close them or put such restrictions in place that mean people aren't going to go to them, they've got to financially support them because it's so short-sighted to go, well, everyone's just going to have to retrain. Retrain as what? Because every other industry is going to be massively overpopulated. There's not going to be any jobs. We can't all go and get a job in it. The easiest thing to get a job in is a bar. That's where people normally go when you come out of work. I'll just go and work in bars or supermarkets for a bit. There's not going to be any jobs there because that's where everyone else is going to be. You can't just dismiss millions of people in the entertainment, hospitality industry and then go, oh, well, just go and be a carpet fitter. Everyone's going to have a carpet next week. They're not going to want a new carpet for 5 years.
Charcoal as well. Charcoal. You'll not be able to find charcoal carpets. You have to paint your own, babe.
I don't know what the best thing to do is. I just know that what the government is doing is wrong. And every time they come out with a policy, I was saying this to Carly today, and we've said it on the mental health episode of this. If you announce a government policy and a dickhead driving in his fucking Kia Sportage to his fucking studio in Runcorn can go, I can see an immediate problem with that. Then why can't the health secretary? We're gonna put a curfew in place. And yes, we want every pub to, it has to shut at 10.
Oh, is he going louder? That was the most loud I've ever known you. I think it might be the new mics, but I just went, oh, Jesus.
Let's shut all the pubs at 10 o'clock. That's really good, actually, because people get more drunk after 10 and they start hugging and kissing. And that's the thing. It's the time. That's why it's spreading. We'll shut them at 10. What? No, people won't start drinking earlier in the day. Don't be ridiculous. This is Britain.
They wouldn't possibly go into each other's homes and not listen to any restrictions. We've told them not to.
We'll put them all on the exact same bus home.
That'll be
all
good.
All of them.
A huge taxi rank at fucking 10 to 10. What a great idea.
The people in power are career politicians. Do you know what it needs? It needs an Ali G. It needs someone.
He's gone mental.
It needs someone.
Keep it real.
Who actually knows working class normal life and who isn't trained in how to be a politician.
Are you standing for parliament? This is it.
I'd love to just be like, Joe, I'd love to be like the little caretaker manager. Because you know, like when a team's fighting relegation.
Sorry, go.
You know, like a Premier League team's fighting relegation and they just bring someone in to just get them out. Sam Allardyce.
You look like Sam Allardyce as well.
You used to get called Sam Allardyce.
Oh, this is amazing.
Guys, let's get Sam Allardyce in. I'll take
Fuck
over.
Fuck off the Tories.
Fuck the Tories
get
off.
Get a 28-year-old Scouse lad in.
We need to keep this team in the Premier League, right? We need to keep this country in the Premier League. I mean, it isn't, but we need to keep this country in League Two. We need to keep this country up, right? So you bring me in. Someone, because I'd have so much more respect for these politicians if they weren't so trained in how to dodge questions. When they get asked a question, they're like, well, you know, we can't really talk about that, so I'll just talk about this other thing that I've prepared and practiced in the mirror. You just need someone to come out. Because the country is quite empathetic towards this pandemic, I think. I think they could be if it was done the right way. There's not really a country in the world who's smashed it. Everyone's got problems. It's a global thing. But we're doing really badly. Really, really badly. And watching Boris Johnson or fucking Hancock or Sunak, any of them come on the news and go, look, right. And Dominic Cummings is there going, what are you doing? Just shut up, Dominic. I can't be arsed anymore. I need to tell the truth. Look, we haven't got a fucking...
Is this Adam Rowe MP?
Yeah.
Yes.
So just go on the news and go, look, we don't fucking know what we're doing. We're fucked. We didn't know how to handle it. We tried one way, it didn't work. We tried the other way, it didn't work. We tried to do half and half, it didn't work. We don't really know what we're doing. We're trying our fucking best here. We're just going to have to shut everything for a few weeks. We know it's a nightmare. We know it's going to be it's going to be hard to not go and see your ma and that. But we really, really, really need to just try this for a month. Let's just get everyone in for a month.
No, is this you talking or them?
Me?
What are you talking about shutting things for?
I'm not saying that's my part. I'm just saying just make a decision and stop going, mate. Well, we might meet. Just go, look, we're really sorry. We need to try this way. And in a month, if it hasn't worked, then we'll try the other way. But we can't do half and half anymore because it's just not fucking working.
Oh, order. Can I just do my order?
Let's have a referendum.
They're
always good.
I was behind you every step of the way. You were swearing on the Andrew Marr show. I was having a fucking great time. I'm voting Tory Lid. And then you were like, we'll have a bit of a shutdown. Like, don't stop shutting things down. Stop.
I don't want to shut things up. Do you want to know what I'd actually say? Listen, guys, right, look, we fucked this. It's really bad. We're one of the worst countries in the world. We don't really know what we're doing. And it's about time now that we just go, do you know what? Some of your nans are going to die, but let's get back to Pop World.
Imagine.
Yes, mate. He's there. Look, that's what I wanted to hear.
Look,
see you, Beryl.
We know your nan's like at risk. We know she's fat. We know your granddad's got asthma. But at the end of the day, tell them to stay in the fucking cupboard and let's go and have some Jaeger bombs. That would be my government policy.
Imagine if you got into power, into Parliament.
Yeah.
Imagine the smear campaign on you.
Yeah.
How long would he fucking last?
Imagine what they'd dig up.
Imagine.
It'd be unbelievable.
Oh my God. Oh.
No wonder he wants everything open. He always wants it open too soon, doesn't he? Like fucking McDonald's in Penrith.
Yes, fucking you pissing on midgets on the front of the sun.
Labour Party retweeting Keir Starmer like, fucking hell, lad, were you in Penrith?
Just look, I am not actually totally against a full shutdown for a month. I'm also not totally against a full open. Do you know what I'm against? This half-assed, let's just try and do this and that and whatever. Just make a fucking decision. Just pick a go and stick with it for a month. And if it doesn't work, then just do the other one.
Just stop. And can I counter that with, I get what you mean, because it's that's fatigue with the flip-flapping.
Yeah.
That's annoying. Stop shutting businesses down. It's fucking wrong.
Or
there is a pandemic.
Or
I get it.
If you're going to shut
There's
them
restriction.
Down,
order,
financially support
order,
them.
Order. You stop shutting businesses down. Put restrictions on. Ask people to be sensible. Put rules in place. Ask the vulnerable to grow the fuck up and look after themselves. Like, I get it. It's not great. But pushing a whole country into a recession is a fucking nightmare. And I don't know what the legalities are of making a business close. Like, at what point do you infringe on fucking rights? Never mind, I'd rather do it 2 weeks than this, 2 weeks than that. Like, do all of the rules. Let's make it, like, coherent if we can. But stop closing businesses down. It's insane.
I don't think any of it's legal, you know. You know, if I paint protest, you know, if they turn up and, like, here's a 10 grand fine. I burped a bit.
Are you all right, mate? I thought Adam was going to be like, you know, in our paint process, my dad worked in paint. His dad worked in paint. He fucking painted the fucking wigwam.
If our paint process...
Charcoal.
Charcoal cathedral.
The neutral cathedral, lad. The priest is like a fuck loads of lads in this.
Oh.
Sorry. Oh, naughty bitch.
If they turn up and they're like, oh, you can't do this protest. Nah. It's clearly a stand-up gig. And we'll be like, fucking isn't, mate. Look at the poster. It says protest. Right. If they turn up and give me a 10 grand fine, I'd be so happy about it. I haven't got 10 grand. I haven't got 10 grand to pay a fine. And I wouldn't pay it because there's absolutely fucking zero chance that 10 grand fine stands up in court. I'm telling you, all these laws that they've passed have not gone through the lawmaking process. A government doesn't just have the power to go, oh, here's a new law. We've decided this is a new law. It's not how it works.
They sort of do at the moment. They've got.
No, they don't.
Like OJ.
They have. They've got emergency COVID, but it's massively undemocratic.
Right? Yeah. And exactly. And we live in a democratic society. There's no... I'd wipe my ass with the 10 grand fine. Take me to court. It'd be great publicity.
It'd be fucking...
Can you imagine the publicity for this podcast?
That'd be...
It'd be worth 10 grand.
Mate.
It'd be worth 10 grand.
That'd be... I'd be Johnny Cochran. You could be OJ. You can be Rob Kardashian.
Yeah.
Put gloves on and that.
Yeah.
I feel like Rob Kardashian surrounded by fucking mental women. Mate.
What?
Your politics is exciting. Borderline confusing. Definitely loud. But... Don't try and pay a £10,000 fine.
I'm not going to pay
with
it.
With stolen rakes and fucking poles from the range.
I'm
not going
to pay it. I'm going to wipe my ass with it.
Oh.
I need a shite, actually. Can we have a break?
All right, okay, good. What a beautiful segue. Touché. See you in a bit, Liz.
Ah, Felicia. What's happening, guys? Today's sponsor is beer52.com. They are the UK's number one craft beer discovery club.
And they've teamed up with us to give our listeners a free case of beer.
That means you get 8 free beers, an award-winning beer magazine, and a tasty snack as your first free order.
And it's free. You pay nothing. You just pay the £5.95 postage and packaging.
You'll then be a member of their Craft Beer Discovery Club, and they send you a different theme of beers every month. Past themes have been the beers of Belgium, the beers of Korea, California, all over the world. Every month, a new theme, and they're always a belter.
You'll find craft beers that you'll never find on your own, and also, you can pause your membership at any time.
So do us a favour, support the podcast, support our sponsors, go to beer52.com/weird. That's beer52.com/WORD.
Every time you sign up, we get a little bit of money, so you get your free beers. There's a little bit of money to support the podcast. It's win-win. I'm a member. I love it.
Let's get back to the podcast. But go and get some beers. Pause it here. Go and get some beers.
B52. Left a good job in the city. Working for the man every night and day.
What's up?
What's up?
This is a much better musical instrument than a triangle. Give me a song.
It is a triangle.
Stan. Elton John.
It's just... Man's a fucking moron.
And I can't see at all.
That's bass though. You need, it's percussion, isn't it? It's not, not the entire fucking bass line.
Oh.
Oh.
Ow.
I was saying to him,
stick your headphones on. I want to play this to the listeners.
That'll become
talking about music. Is what?
That'll become Pavlovian. In like a year, he'll hear that and think he's...
Oh. Yeah, every time someone wants to get off a bus, I'm like, I wasn't lying. Yo, it's time to have a word with Adam and Dan. Sensei Carl, who is back from Japan. It's the funniest podcast in all of the land. Listen to the shit whenever you can. Subscribe, like, and share while they try to please you. The last thing for me is... Bye, Felicia. Bye, Felicia. Yes! Mate, Ben King, what a fucking ledge. Ben Kingsley, Bingers UK on YouTube. Go and have a look at his YouTube. He sent us that in. I love it when we get the music stuff in. I also love a bit of drum and bass. Used to go to a bit of D&B when I was at...
Oh, we've had a couple of people ask as well. I know you're working on it, so I think we should tell people. We've had a few of you ask about a PO box because you just want to send us some stuff, and we're fucking well up for that. We are going to have a PO box sorted as soon as possible. We're working on it, and you'll be able to send us some shit because we want gifts.
We've got it.
Have we got it?
We've got it.
Oh, someone sending me a signed Everton shirt.
Oh, yeah. Pete Gaydon.
Absolute legend, yeah.
Oh, God. Signed Everton shirt. They was like, sure, Adam won't want it, you know.
But do you know, have you seen, you know Pete Gaydon who tweets us all the time?
Yeah.
He tweeted Carl and was like, all right, lads, I've got a signed Everton shirt here. You can have it.
He inboxed me on Instagram, been chatting to him, said he'll send it to me whenever I'm ready.
He's one of our biggest weirders, him.
Legend.
One of the weirders.
You just have to send it to Have a Word, which is the Heath Business and Technical Park, Runcorn, Cheshire, WA7 4QX. So, the Heath Business and Technical Park in Runcorn, WA7 4QX. Just put Have a Word, and they will get it to us.
Can you pop that the words of that on the screen so people can just see it? Sweet,
you're very kind. What's he called? He's that's just sent that jingle in. I fucking love a bit of
Ben
drum and
Kingsley.
Bass. I miss dancing.
You sound like an old widow.
I know. I do. I'd love to.
I just want to go dancing again with my Frank.
We'll meet again. But the irony is,
Frank used to take me dancing on Thursdays, and now he's gone.
It's so true. That's how I feel about like pills and drum and bass. Like how, like he died 20 years ago. And sometimes I go to the ballroom and I have a lime and soda and think of him. I want to do that, except with ecstasy and drum and bass.
It was so much more romantic how like our grandparents used to meet, wasn't it? You know what I mean? Like ballroom dancing and that.
Yeah.
Do you reckon they were as dirty as
did
we
did your
are?
Grandparents meet ballroom dancing?
My nan, me nan told me that she met me granddad at ballroom
your
dancing.
Your nan's a slag, isn't she, though?
What?
What the fuck? Dude, that is too much. Mate, we'll do mum jokes. We're not doing fucking nan jokes. Cha, upset me. Nasty upset Carlos. Me. Who the fuck has ever said that so seriously? No, lad, though. Your nan's a fucking slag, mate.
What are you saying? That's me.
She sucks off bus drivers for Werther's Originals, mate. She's a fucking mega rider.
We say that to each other about 6 times a day.
Mate.
If his nan ever comes up. Yeah.
Comes you up keep... You,
the arch.
keep my nan out of this. She's a fucking
nan
saint.
Nan like that. Nan no. like that.
No. What? I'll do any joke. What? I even get called a Tory by Steph Johnson, although it fucking rankles.
Why?
You keep man. She's a saint.
Is she though?
She was.
Do you reckon?
Nana, if you can hear me.
Now she's a real saint.
I mean, everything that's it.
No, Nan's a saint. They're all horrible racists.
Yeah. And is your nan is a racist and she took some dick in her time.
Is this a slaggy racist?
Oh. I can't do it. She's an angel.
How long did she live? How old was she when she went?
Oh, she's gone.
She's gone.
Oh, it's fine. But how old was she?
Oh, is it fine if she's gone?
Yeah.
She was an angel before she died, and now she's in.
How old was she when she died?
92.
92.
Don't say anything about dicks. Don't say slag.
76 years she was taking pipe.
Oh!
Legally.
Upset yeah. Me. Oh. Bitch. Upset me. Nasty bitch.
76 years
of pipe.
Yeah.
You 12 years fucking horrible rats.
She was, though.
I'd rather you did jokes about my granddad taking fucking pipe.
Yeah, but he didn't. He was piping you, man.
He laid the pipe.
Oh. You're awful people.
Do you reckon he was doing mad shit back then?
No, she's off. I'm ring fencing her.
Do you reckon the 30s? Do you reckon he was 69 and that?
No, they weren't even kissing with tongues.
Tongues?
They were literally like, I like you. I saw your dance. Would you dance the...
It was a kiss. And let's put you on the barbecue.
All right,
that's
Danny Mac.
That's a thing, that. My girlfriend says that.
Bit of wordplay there. that's got two meanings. Yeah, they were just, you know, they had to just dance one way on a dance floor.
Yeah.
On, you know, at the ballroom.
Yeah.
And then they'd see a girl and they'd have to write to her father. And then a postman would have to take the telegram round to her father. And he'd be like, yes, you can. Stop.
Yeah.
Take her for a dance. Stop. Then he had to go back to the dance floor. And she'd be like, would you join me in a tango?
Yeah, that's why, all sir? In the public eye. But when they got back, do you reckon she got stuffed or what?
Smoking the pole.
No, mate. No, mate. I think it was like 4 dates before they even like held hands.
Do you reckon, yeah?
Legally.
Yeah, but I mean...
It was like Sharia law, but, you know.
Who's that?
No, but like, you know, once they were married and that, do you reckon they ever got fucking... Were they getting volleyed and that? Because sometimes now I sleep with a girl and I feel like I've accidentally walked into an MMA bout, do you know what I mean? Because they fucking go for it, some of these women.
Things have changed.
Yeah.
Television has evolved, like it's different now, isn't it?
Yeah. But do you not reckon like nanas... Yeah, like they can't all have been all just no, just missionary, please, and then I'll get back on with the dishes. It can't have all been that. I reckon some nans like getting fucking, you know, arm barred and that.
Yeah. Well, yours did. Mine just literally was like handshake and a thorough fucking.
How do you know?
Insemination.
Handshake with what?
No, they didn't.
Do you not reckon? Bad. Everyone's had sex. Oh, everyone who's.
No, I'm not talking about. I know that. I'm here, aren't I? Yeah. I get that. I'm not just talking about like fucking heavy. Do you know stuff. What I mean? Bang brothers over here.
Hanging off the ceiling.
Like, do you think, right, your nan, when they all came back from the fucking war, there was just gangbangs everywhere. Like,
when you got back from the
we'll
war.
We'll meet again. Don't know. And then fucking all
there's
over her face.
Absolutely.
Yeah, my white cliffs have Dover.
But there's absolutely no way that your granddad came back from the war and then they just had nice missionary sex and then watched fucking Emmerdale.
Yeah, he broke a hip.
Yeah. That's I'm going to go home. I'm going to break my wife's hip.
I can't do it. I can't do it. I can't do this about my nana. She's in it.
10 minutes into it. I can't
do
it. This.
No, what episode is it? Is it 89? I can't do it.
69.
I can't do it. Also, no. You've really upset me. Will me. When did it get freaky? What year?
The 70s.
Oh, is it? You said that with 60s, loads.
60s, Summer of Love.
No, but they were all stoned. They couldn't do mad shit.
Do you know the Summer of Love, when people say that shit? Do you know your parents were still in fucking Dovecot in the Summer of Love? It wasn't like...
Dovecot?
Dovecot.
Dovecot.
Was, all that, right, was that 1969?
Yeah, it was about there.
Well, there you go, 69. Must have fucking loved it.
All right.
Is that why they call it 69?
No. Yeah, it is.
Is that what it is?
Why are you going so smutty?
I'm not.
When do you think it was... Do you think the Summer of Love was just everywhere? Like even like Moscow and shit. I think it was just quite specific to some parts of the States and maybe, you know, London. I don't think in Preston, Lancashire, I was like, oh man, it's just free love, man. Oh, let's, you know, bomb by the Ribble.
I love the River Ribble. When I drive past it, it always looks lovely.
Have you had a coffee as well? Where's your ADD going? I like the Ribble.
Your nana's a slag. 1969 was dirty. And I like the River Ribble. Welcome to the Northern Nobbits podcast.
All I'm saying is I don't think your nana's as innocent as you'd like to think. I think we all have this sort of perception that our nans are these innocent angels.
Well, you clearly don't, because he knows something about your nan.
No, he's just being lads, isn't he? Your nan's just like, ah. But in reality,
she is. Yeah.
She is a mess.
No, but she got fucking plastered, didn't she, by his granddad.
Yeah.
And great-granddad.
Yeah.
Not nice. Question? sorry, I just threw up because you're talking about my beautiful nana. All right, lids. This
was
feels.
Your nan fit, yeah?
Oh, shut up, man! She's a fucking saint, nana. If you can hear me, I regret every bad thing that he said.
Shout out.
Do you reckon he's shagging heaven?
What?
If you're pointing up.
Will you get the mic near your fucking head?
If you're pointing up to her.
Yeah.
What do you reckon she's doing now?
I don't. I'm just doing that for effect. I'm just doing that for N-dubs. I don't think she's up there. She's not an angel or a saint. She's dead. But let's not besmirch her memory like you think she got besmirched. No, I don't. Yeah, I think if there is a heaven, you've got a bang in heaven, haven't you?
Yeah. I think heaven is your, whatever your, if there is a heaven, I think it's whatever your idea of heaven is.
Yeah. What my, as we've said it before, my idea of heaven gets me thrown out of heaven. Because there's bare big titty flapping in my face. Do you know what I'm saying? God loves a motorboat.
Yeah.
God
knows the score.
God's actually sound. Do you know what I mean?
That's the most Scouse thing ever. If you'd like to study philosophy and theology at the University of Liverpool. No, lads. Hey, God is sound. He's all right. He invented Garry's, didn't he?
He did.
He invented man who invented Garry's. So fucking get on it, lad.
How do we all know? Right. Because God, as far as we know, God wrote the Bible or told people to write it.
No.
He inspired it, didn't he?
He didn't write the Bible.
Inspired other people to write it. Yeah. Divine inspiration.
Sort of.
How do we know that wasn't the devil, right?
Oh, my God.
And he's like made everyone be like, there's these rules and that. God just made us all, was like, yeah, you all want to fuck each other. Have some fucking limo and that. There you go. On Earth, there's loads of trees. No,
I'd love it.
Have a good time there.
How right? good with it.
Right? And he's like, yeah, I'm done. I'm fucking out. I don't even need to keep an eye on you.
Where does the devil come in?
What?
Where does the devil come in?
Because the devil is God's brother and he's fuming because God robbed his idea to make a sick gaff like the earth. And the devil's like, nah, I'm fucking ruined. I'm going to make them all think that if they do everything God said is sound, that they'll end up in hell with me. But that's not true. God's just sweet. God's just stoned as fuck. Just he's forgot about us. Because time works differently for him. So like the millions of years there's been since he made it, he's just been like, yeah, I'll put dinosaurs there for the beer and then it'll blow up and it'll lead to humans and that. And he's just having a little spliff. he's sat on a beanbag chair and he's just like, oh, how sound am I? I made that sick gaff for all them humans. They're having a fucking boss time now. They've got ale. They've got fucking...
boobs.
They've got, yeah... you know, Curb Your Enthusiasm, good sitcom. They're like, that films are good. There's, I've boxed them off there. I've Chocolatey inspired Claire's. All of it.
Chocolatey
Claire's, Smarties. He's just like, oh.
Is this your list of things that God gave us? Curb Your Enthusiasm and Smarties.
Just like, Toy Story 2.
God did, right? He gave us your dinosaurs and then he left us alone and forgot about us. But he did write a sub-clause in Toy Story 2, Smarties and Kirby Enthusiasm.
No, he hasn't forgot about us, but like he's just like, they'll be sound. But that amount of time, although it's like millions of years to us, it feels like it's been about half an hour to him.
Yeah.
So he's just watched like one episode of Emmerdale.
Always with Emmerdale. My nana banging.
He's watched one episode of Emmerdale. And like, it's coming to the end now. And he's like, fucking Zach Dingle, brat him. And now he's going to come back in a bit. And he's going to look and be like, what the fuck's going on here? And then he'll be fuming with the devil. And then he'll come in the sky, God. And he'll be like, listen, all these rules and that, nothing to do with me, mate. And then it'll rain Garry's. And he'll just be like, oh, get off get off your tits.
Is that the rapture?
What?
Is that the rapture?
It'll rain Garry's.
The Scouse rapture. It's gone fucking proper moody up there. Fucking hell, it's fucking raining, Garry's.
Like, you know this idea you've got that when you die, it's shit.
And then you'll look up and you'll see my nana banging everyone in heaven like, nana? Now the drugs don't work.
Yeah.
Imagine if God was a Scouser.
For a living. God is death or a Scouser. There's absolutely no way God is a Scouser. That's why we nicknamed it Robbie Fowler.
Okay. And that there's is no the way first that God semester isn't a Scouser. Of theology at Liverpool University. God is a Scouser. God, if he exists, or she exists, Adam, or they exist, because God is quite
there's
likely
no way it's a woman, because then he wouldn't neutral have left us alone.
It's whatever you see, isn't it?
Wow.
It's you. He's a manifestation of whatever you want him to be.
No, I think he's a fella. Like, I think he's just a normal guy.
No, but if you're going to get to heaven, if there is a God, yeah, and it's going to look different to everyone, it might look similar to you two.
No.
And I honestly think Alfie Brown had a point a few Patreon episodes ago about
not human?
Morgan Freeman.
Like he's a helicopter or something.
Your God
no
is, do you, honestly, Carl, you sound like the voice of reason so fucking much on this podcast, but you sounded like a special kid that he's trying to steal from at the range.
I've had my first Lucas Aid in 19 months. I'm not even messing.
My God is a helicopter. You know fucking Harold from Thomas the Tank Engine? Da.
I reckon God is just like, he is, he said, if there's a God, he's a humanoid type thing, but he's just like, you know, he's on it.
Well summed up.
He's just on it and he knows how to do stuff and he's bock. And he made this as like a big party house for us. And then the devil had a little whisper and was like, hey, I'm God, mate. Don't be fucking shagging each other before you're married and that. And God's not asked. God's just like, shag who you want.
Knows the score, you know.
Yeah.
I think some of God's representatives on earth would argue with some of the points
you've
all
made. Been tricked. The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world that he wasn't God.
All right. Pacino's films. What? Yeah.
That's not a Pacino film.
Is it not?
The Usual Suspects.
Oh, shit.
And like Cards that. Associated. Exactly. I'm talking about weed. Listen to the quote. See, they leave clues everywhere like that. He's gone.
It's like you smoke weed. Have you smoked weed in the toilet in the break? Because this is like the chats we had.
I haven't smoked weed for about 5 years.
Honestly, when we were getting wrecked for the first time, we were about 18. These are the fucking chats we had.
These are the talks we always have.
And now I'm paying my mortgage with them.
I swear to God, I think if God's real, he's actually dead sound.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because that speech, it's all in that the devil's advocate speech that I imitate sometimes. He's right, isn't he? The devil's right. He gives man instincts. And then what does he do? He sets the rules in opposition. Look, but don't touch. Touch, but don't taste.
P.S.
Taste.
Those rules were not
don't
set
swallow
out by God. They were set out by the people who purport to represent him.
No, they and were they, set out by the devil through the Peter,
Pope,
Paul, and Jesus.
The
Jesus
Pope,
is a rat as
priests,
well.
All bishops. They represent God. They speak for God as much as the head of the Elvis fan club speaks for Elvis. They don't speak for God, do they? They represent people who believe in God, but they don't actually speak for God. My miles off here. They've gone, I'm the Pope and I speak to God. You don't know.
Yeah, but aren't they, is it omnipotent or
I reckon Jesus was in.
God is, yeah.
I reckon Jesus was one of the devil's boys.
Isn't the Pope omniscient?
No, he's just a bloke, mate, in a big frock.
No, I don't believe in it, but I'm saying he says he's omnipotent and omniscient.
He's not all powerful and all loving, is he?
No, he's just got
all knowing.
He's got God's WhatsApp.
Yeah. He's got him on speed dial.
But I reckon Jesus.
The church are like on God's Patreon.
Yeah.
Or everyone else is just.
They
like,
get everything.
You know, yeah.
But episodes. I reckon Jesus was one of the devil's boys. Look at him. He looks like a goth. Tell me I'm wrong.
That was nearly
Jesus.
That was
like
nearly as bad as God is a helicopter. That
Jesus a goth. Jesus looks like a goth, doesn't he? If Jesus, like, because they paint him in fucking white and that, put a black, a long leather coat on Jesus, and he looks like a Satanist.
We're piss testing you.
Jesus looks like he hangs around the court in the city centre. Jesus has got a skateboard.
Loves Monster.
Yeah. Jesus drinks Monster by the fucking gallon, mate.
Relentless Monster.
Yeah.
Relentless Monster.
Both of them. Relentless Monster and it's another goth one, isn't it?
Jesus's entire Spotify playlist is My Chemical Romance.
And his skateboards.
But like everywhere. The early stuff before Black Parade. And I'm not judging. Be a goth all you want. Goth lives matter. But he is a goth.
So would you rather then?
Oh, God. It's such stupid balance.
Hey, guys, really enjoyed the mental health podcast, but hate you guys for making me teary. My would you rather is...
can't go from Jesus is a goth to mental health, thank you. It's
the full breadth of the fucking experience of Have a Word. This is from Angel. Angel, okay. My would
girl,
you...
you're my angel. You're my darling angel. Just like my peeps, you are to me.
Why are you doing the Bollywood version of it? That's
what he sounds like.
That sounded
in... You're my angel.
You're my darling, you're my angel, darling. Bengal to Bengali. Karaoke. Mike.
I fucking love a bit of Shaggy, you know.
Paul Smith.
You love a bit of Shaggy?
Yeah.
Yeah?
He's fucking shit hot.
He's got wild eyes.
Yeah.
You can't see it properly. He's got wild eyes. And it goes, it's a combination of like caffeine and concentration and like how long we've been doing it. But he just looked over then and he was like, I love Shaggy. I'm like, oh my God. He needs to be CRB checked. He's fucking mad. Like, I've got your kids. I'm doing the swimming lesson. Yeah. Oh. You love Shaggy?
Yeah. I would love to be able to do, you know, like the mumble raps he does at the start of...
How
like,
much to book, Shaggy?
The start of Angel.
He's gone.
That's Scatman.
That is Scatman.
I'm a Shagman.
Yeah, the train's off the track now.
Right. You have mentioned this festival. You mentioned it a couple of episodes ago. Doing a festival next year. I Have a Word festival. I can't get it out of my head as a brilliant idea. We could have live podcast. We could have you doing a stand-up show, me doing a stand-up show. We could get our favourite lids who've been on, Eshan, and we could get guest appearances by Steph Johnson fucking making Dalla Dalla. We could get Rudy on.
If you haven't listened to the bonus episode we put out last week with Steph Johnson, it's one of the best, if not the best episode we've ever done. So go and listen to it as soon as you're done with this one.
Can I have Dictionary Corner?
Yeah, Carl, we're doing a 2-dayer. Like we're doing a Saturday and a Sunday in Liverpool. We're doing a Have a Word festival. You're gonna make at least an appearance, aren't you? Fucking hell. How much to book Shaggy to close? Yes. Who would you... we could probably stretch the budget to one live musical act. I wanna do a bit of
Ed Sheeran.
Can't afford him.
I think he might be out of budget.
The Lighthouse Family.
What, or Lifted?
Or Simply Red.
All right. Carl's mum, thanks for those suggestions.
Both of them knock bangers out.
Right, okay. Lifted. Yeah, but Shaggy would be Lifted. Shaggy would be funnier. To close the Saturday night, we've got a musical act on. We've got... You'd want Shaggy, wouldn't you? How much to book Shaggy? You get him for 5.
I just love the thoughts of Shaggy turning up in a fucking field in Crocky Park. Who the fuck booked me for this? Wasn't me. Yes! Yes! You rang me on Tuesday? Wasn't me.
Suggestions?
You just sent me a WhatsApp?
Fucking
wasn't
up.
Me.
He's gone. We're going to have to get some food in him. I want suggestions for the live act for the Have a Word Festival. Obviously, it's got to be post-COVID, hasn't it?
Yeah.
We've got a thank you show to do.
We'll do a Have a Word protest.
You love a fucking protest. You'll be in prison for protesting by then. What did you do in the second lockdown, Adam? I did about 2.5 months, yeah.
Have a Word, live from Walton Nick.
You could be on Nelson Mandela. You can do the voice as well.
Free!
I want to live in a world where podcasts are legal to do live shows.
Yeah. Introduce Shaggy like that.
Oh my God. Shaggy is here.
A fucking weird one, isn't it? If you just rewind the YouTube, you'd be like, "What were you losing your shit about government restrictions and civil liberty 28 minutes ago?" Yeah, and now he's like, "Oh my God,
I want to live in the world. He had beef with the government as well.
Who, Yoda?
Did he? Are you likening yourself to Mandela there?
Yeah, yeah. Me and Nelson were fucking almost the same. He fought for his freedom for 30 years. I did a fucking gig in a paint factory. Same. Exactly the same.
It's not exactly the same.
And Jesus is a nonce.
No, he's not a nonce.
Carl's God's a helicopter. No. And Dan's nana is a fucking saint.
Jesus is not a nonce. He's a goth.
A goth.
A monster drinking, skateboard wielding, leather jacket owning, emo goth.
Okay.
What's the difference between an emo and a goth?
That honestly, I thought that was a joke.
Google no.
It really, like, there's going to be like, guys going, oh my God, I can't even believe you're asking that question.
Is this like offensive to ask this question? Do they get all pissed off about it?
No, that political correctness has not gone.
Not
like, you're not getting cancelled. I cannot believe, as a goth, you just call me an emo.
Emos express themselves in poetry and critiques on post-punk philosophy. Goths, on the other hand, are related to black magic, vampires, and witchcraft.
And don't use deodorant.
Yeah. And don't use
deodorant. All right, cool. What website did you pull that from off, like, fucking dadsresearchthechildren.co.uk?
Genuinely, the difference between .net.
Wicked.
I want to live in a world where we go for a little break.
Can we go for a break?
You've got a question.
I genuinely don't think we can follow that level of nonsense. You need food. You've got crazy eyes.
You have as well. You know it. You know it. Now he gets like, no, I can do it.
No, go on. Let's do a question.
I'm not. That's not. Let's not. Let's have a break. And we've got Lloyd Griffith coming in. It's exciting. Ready? It's going to be great. I'm really looking forward to this. He's going to be quality. Let's have a little interval and we'll be back with Lloyd Griffith.
What's the difference between pasta and spike noodles?
I don't know. Do you want to...
Yeah, I'm not.
Tell us when Lloyd's here.
Nice one. See you in a bit, lad. All right there, lids. I want to tell you about our sponsor, Supreme CBD. If you've not yet used Supreme CBD or any CBD products, try them now. They can actually improve your quality of life. If you've got any problems with sleep, anxiety, any skin issues, I've got it. I use it. It's really good for your skin. It comes in gummy bear form. You've got sprays. You've got tablets. It's incredible for improving your general health and happiness. Try it out at supremecbd.uk and use our code WORD, WORD, to save 30% off all orders with code WORD, WORD. Nice one.
Hey, what you gonna do? We're back.
What am I fucking doing here?
Hey, I'm walking here.
Hey.
Welcome back to part two. He looks fucking terrified. What have I turned up to? What's going on?
Hiya, Lloyd.
Hiya, mates. I've gone plural there.
Sam.
Right.
Do you know what? I was thinking about a lot. That I was driven from London.
Heard of it.
And I was like, the last two times that I saw you two were both terrifying experiences.
Why?
Well, firstly, your introduction when you brought me on stage at Shrewsbury Castle and Garden.
Shouldn't have done that.
Still have flashbacks to that. And then when I saw you, I got mistaken for Adam Rowe by Jonathan Ross, who I'd worked with twice before. And I was like, he goes, oh, no, he's had a minute. I was like, no, it's Lloyd. It was like, we did the roast battle together. He was like, oh, yeah. And I was like, we all look the same, do we? on a quite diverse show. I was like, oh, we all look the same, do we? And he was like, oh, and just... Scurried off.
I introduced Lloyd.
Geez, private. Go on.
I introduced Lloyd at Shrewsbury Castle, and
the gig we did together.
Yeah, the next night Lloyd was on.
What do you?
What did I say? I was basically building you up normally, yeah. And then I could see you walking around the back, and in my head I was like, "Well, me and Lloyd are mates. I'll make this dead fun." And I was like, "He is one of my favourite black comedians working in the UK today." And Shrewsbury are so white-collared, like, oh.
I don't think you need to put the word collared in there.
They're so white.
Yeah.
But they just, it was almost like the crowd wanted to just go, Dan, he's not black. Like, you walked on and they were obviously confused. And you're like, could it be a joke that I was playing?
I panicked because, you know, still not, you know, I've been gigging quite a lot since post-lockdown. I wouldn't say I was like at the prime. So you still, there's a little bit of rust that you're trying to
not totally match fit.
I'd say I'm, you know, going, oh,
not
get away
black
with it.
Comedian introduction fit.
I'd say I'm like, sub me off after 76 minutes kind of fit. Do you know what I mean? I
can't, he's had a run full, out.
I can't do the full stint, but he's gone, he's put a good shift in there. And so I just went, I'm not black. And I didn't know what to do. And they went, yeah, we agree with that. I was like, yeah, cheers, Dan. And
I was on the side like, why? Why? Because I'm like, oh, their sound, Lloyd's sound. The night before, we'd been there and they were into that sort of silly stuff.
Do you know what
and
it is?
And then the Saturday night, they were rigid.
I know exactly what it is. I know why you've done that as well. Because we do this at the minute 3 times a week. And we can say whatever we want. There's no audience to immediately respond to it. And everyone who does watch it knows who we are now. And they know that we're a pair of bellends. And also, 2 of the gigs you've done recently. So I run a gig in Liverpool once a month on a Sunday. I call it Secret Sundays. The lineup's never listed. And he's done the first 2 of them. And we've both ended up on stage together, just talking shit for a bit. And you're in that zone. And you've had a thought and gone, this'll be fine. And you're in a castle outdoors in Shrewsbury to people who didn't know you, didn't know him.
It's funny though, wasn't it?
Yeah. I've got a new lady at the moment and basically brought her to the gig, and it was like one of the first times if not the first time she'd see me. And she just went, so is that an in-joke between you two? I was like, no, it wasn't. That's not what we do.
That's one of the bits of your banter.
And it was, it was an absolutely fine gig.
You've got a new lockdown lady.
No, what is it? I don't know what that means.
Pandemic love?
No, just met like last month. I don't know. Like,
all right, okay.
Where did you meet her?
The internet.
Which bit
of it? You said it like it was a pub. Have you heard of the internet?
Which bit of the dark web?
How old is she?
A dating app. Just a dating app. We don't have to talk about that.
All right, there's more stuff to talk about.
I mean, why are you getting the big dog on and then talking about his girlfriend?
Are you feeling match fit now, gig-wise? You're back?
Yeah, kind of. I was doing a lot of Zoom gigs online, and then, I didn't mind them. I didn't mind them at all. But the thing is, though, I'm not your archetypal joke teller. I will just talk or just do impressions or sing. Do you know what I mean? So like, I can get away with it. Oh, no.
Singing impressions?
No, do you know what? I heard your impressions and they're just syllables, mate. They are just syllable impressions.
He's doing well though, isn't he?
Yeah. I mean, it says a bloke who literally does tape impressions. So I mean, like,
it's... You do what impressions?
Sellotape impressions. Oh, come on.
Have you not seen his set?
Act like you haven't seen it.
Have you never seen it before?
I haven't seen your sellotape impression.
Come on. Yeah, I just basically use like... for like 7 minutes. Feels time, doesn't it? But,
when you've just done it there, people are going to be like, that's not a proper bit. And when you're in the magic of Shrewsbury Castle grounds and you've just done a racially insensitive intro, it's amazing how much it does work.
Snotted at that, well done.
It was really... It does work.
Yeah, but, so it's... it's weird, but I get away with it. But it's like no one's doing it, to be fair. Hopefully no one's doing like little fat bloke that sings like a woman. No one's doing cathedral quiz. No one's doing sellotape impressions. Do you know what I mean? So I'm like,
bitingly original.
Yeah, but
no one's doing the tax return on stage.
Yeah, no, but
I'm edgy.
When are you going to do it? Do you know what I mean? And then that's tax deductible. But I've been doing quite a bit, really. I've been doing quite a lot of stand-up, and then we did the Jonathan Ross show, which...
I got cut.
What, did you?
Yeah.
From the show?
Yeah.
I'd never watched the shows that I'm on, so I didn't watch it.
So they told me, agent, like, we've cut 2 acts, you know, because I did a really short set.
Yeah.
So they cut 2 of them all. And I think really what's happened is they've gone... They're just going to think Lloyd's changed his shit.
Because he came on very, like, very
similar. We did the same episode. Like, I don't always totally buy into the whole idea that, you know, like, you can't have the same sort of acts on. But if you're going to book us both for the same series, have us a week apart, at least.
You know what I mean? It's a good job we lost some weight. Otherwise, it would have been fucking identical. So yeah.
I've been stopped so many times in Edinburgh by people who think they've seen my show and they've actually saw his.
And I get stopped by a lot of people thinking I'm the bloke from Axis of Awesome. So it's just kind of like, it's like Russian dolls.
The circle,
and he gets mistaken for Jack Black. Do you know what I mean? So there'll be someone that will go, oh, you look like, you know.
I've had Sam Allardyce before. I had it in the first half of the show.
Sam Allardyce,
the Hunchback of Notre Dame.
That's
I think I called Quasimodo at school for a bit.
Also, as well,
Quasi Rodo.
They did. Oh, wordplay is a fucking nightmare.
Everyone in Liverpool's a comedian.
Quasi Rodo.
Also, as well, I've been looking forward to coming on this because I remember maybe like 2 years ago, we did a gig together and I was like just chatting. You were like, I'm not going to gig anymore. Podcast the future. I was like, what is he on about? He's like, mate, I'm gonna do a podcast. It's gonna be the future. I was like, all right, mate. And you're like, I'm gonna build a podcast studio in my house. He's like, and it's gonna be like.
I remember where we were, and you were like, okay.
It's gonna be like Seth Rogen's podcast. You know what I mean, it's gonna be exactly Seth like Rogen's that. Yeah. And then I was like, oh, and then here you are. I mean, it's not in your.
It was shit. And then I did it with Adam, and it was way better.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that idea I was telling you about was the prequel to it actually being prequel. Oh.
The prequel.
Because that conversation was in 1583.
I think that was just Slate, wasn't it? Prequel.
I like. Hey, that's very good. That's a really good joke.
That went over. Everyone's at a party. I just seen Carl go.
He's been on the best form today. And it's the way he does it, and then he's like...
just look around like, you get that? You get it?
I did a joke. Tonight?
I am.
Yeah, he's going to be... He's
ready.
Wherever
he's
you firing. Are tonight.
Hopefully. Hot water comedy club.
I've heard of that.
Yeah.
And you're going up to Blackpool?
I'm off to Blackpool to the comedy station.
Yeah, right under the tower. Can't miss it.
So I didn't realise that. So it's tonight, doing tonight and tomorrow night. So...
Do you know,
quite
it's
excited.
Done so well getting a comedy club going in Blackpool because it's proper old school, isn't it? Like,
yeah.
Blackpool, we've had comedians here for fucking years. The same ones.
Well, yeah.
It hasn't really had alternative comedy, has it?
I played the comedy station was when it was... It used to be... Have you played it when it was in the nightclub?
I've never played Blackpool at all.
So the one you're playing tonight, fantastic, lovely, purpose-built Thank room. You. But that brand started in a nightclub around the corner called Viva. And when I say nightclub, I don't mean like... R type of nightclub. It's like Blackpool's nightclub. So there's like different rooms with different shit going on. The first time I ever played the comedy station in the little small cupboard room that he had in the main room, sold out with must have been at least 1,000 people, was a Roy Chubby Brown tribute act.
Oh, God.
And I tell you what.
That's Blackpool. That could be happening tonight somewhere in Blackpool.
You know, I didn't agree with everything he said, but that delivery, you learn a lot from people like that. You really do.
That's how you...
He lanes into the racial slurs. He takes a breath and then...
Yeah, that's a mad...
Gigs in nightclubs.
Oh, I've done some hideous ones.
The one in Leeds. Is it the Oceania.
Tiger. Oh, Oceania.
Where you have to walk past the door where you can hear screaming women because there's like Yorkshire Chippendales fucking getting the knobs out.
Oh, I could have doubled up that night. Well, I'm from North East Lincolnshire, not Yorkshire.
Have I told you the story of when I played that for the first time? The Jongleurs Oceania?
Yeah, go on.
So it was my first... I was about a year into comedy. I'd emailed Jongleurs. At the time, Hot Water were trying to be agents, right? So they'd got me... I think I'd emailed or they had on my behalf and they'd got me a tryout for Jongleurs far too soon. And they said, yeah, go to Leeds and just you'll be doing a 10-minute set.
Is this the one where you died on your ass that you talk about on the Justin one?
Yeah.
Justin podcast. Justin episode.
I went to walk on, like the compass got everyone's eating a bag of shit and it was a good bill as well. And he went, right, your next act's a new act. He's just doing a tryout tonight. And he feel the audience go, and he goes, and he's come all the way from Liverpool, and there was a stag doing from Manchester, who just booed for a bit. And did I say who the compere was on?
Oh, did you?
Do you know who it is?
No, did you? Because
who it is?
Yeah.
Have you never seen me before?
Kane Brown.
No, you do, because you've got him on the soundboard.
Yeah.
So yeah,
you know our podcast better than. Isn't it funny?
I forget what I've said on this.
I've listened to one episode, and it's just so happened that it's all come up today. So I look like an absolute.
We do that story every 2 weeks, though. To be fair, we've got it on rotation. That's a fucking good one. That Leeds one. Do your Leeds one again,
it's
lad.
An awful gig that, though.
What is it about crap gigs that comics revel in? It's something, it's like the code, isn't it? When you're like, Lloyd, you've come all this way, you've driven from London, there's been a pandemic, you've found new love, we rarely see each other. Tell us about when you died on your fucking hoop. Your career's going great, you're doing TV. Let's hear when you suffered artistically. I think, though,
that comedians like telling other comedians their shit gig stories because deep down, all comedians want is for other people to like them. And other comedians aren't going to like you if you're just talking about your best gigs.
No one, I don't want to hear about your good gigs. Tell us a stinker.
God, I mean, it'd be awful if I came on and was like, look, I played the O2 five times last year, Wembley four times, and Hammersmith Apollo three times, especially every single one of them. No one wants to hear that, do they?
Supporting. Supporting.
What?
Supporting.
Edit that bit.
he knows the game.
I know the game. Yeah, seriously, fucking know that. But yeah, but it's not those gigs that you want to talk about. Do you know what I mean? You've got them and you look and you know that they're there. Do you know what I mean? So that's absolutely fine.
They're
but
for you. They're for you me. And the promoter.
And I was just chatting, and I think you it would be bad if just someone hadn't died on their ass on stage. Like, it's insane. And I'm sure every single comedian has died, no matter who you are. You know, if you're like someone like a Bander Man who is absolutely bulletproof, like noise next door. I was going to say Terry Alderton, I've seen some of the best gigs I've ever seen anyone ever have in the world, and some of the worst gigs I've ever seen him. But that's what makes him so absolutely incredible. There's no one that has gone, oh, I've not had a bad gig, because it's bullshit for a start. And also, like, that's just not how this works. No matter if I've done support for a couple of big acts, and I've seen them struggle at their own gigs. Not badly, but like struggle.
Weird ones.
In like Work in Progress is all like in big on tour theatre shows?
Bad tour arenas dates. Or theatres, yeah.
Like, but not dying,
just a bad night.
Yeah, just gone, oh, that was a bit weird, wasn't it? You know, and just come
I've
off
seen
and...
Terry Alderton have a weird one.
Yeah. Oh,
yeah. And it is the weirdest thing to watch, a straight killer, like a murderer, have a weird one. I've seen Tom Stade be off. And it's this weird thing where you're like, it feels like... It's the strangest thing. It's like Usain Bolt tripping over.
Yeah.
You know he can be amazing. You're used to him being amazing, but everyone can trip over. Watching guys like that have a weird one, you're like, oh my God, they're human. Because Terry Alderton fucking hoofs gigs.
Oh, in a way.
I was starting out, I think I gigged with him in Brighton, down south. It's an away leg for me.
Yeah.
Felt like fucking Kiev in the Europa League. And I was new, and he was the headliner, and I sort of just shanked it in the middle section. The easiest bit. He went on the Friday night, and it was one of them where you're like, is someone ripping it when you've kind of died? I didn't have the worst one, but it wasn't good enough. And then he ripped it in a way, I was at the back going, ha, 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 maybe I should give this up. Like, it made me question my career. And I've also seen him have a weird one. And he's so good, it's almost like freaky watching him not rip it.
I've seen him have a really bad one in Edinburgh. And I went and saw Terry.
Happen to anyone on any day in Edinburgh.
But the thing is with Terry, like, he is... You know, he is just one of a kind, like absolutely one of a kind. And have you seen Terry Alderton before?
Yeah. He does 5 minutes with his back to the audience,
like doing noises.
tell him.
Doesn't work, you're too far down road, aren't you?
If Terry's one of those people as well, where and like he's one of my favourites of all time. Terry Alderton, Sean Locke, Lee Mack. They're kind of like they're like my three.
Lee Mack's first stand up DVD where he's got the yellow shirt on, is one of the funniest hours ever put on record. It's fucking unbelievably
funny. I think that's one where he's got the joke. I remember the last thing my nana said to me,
what are you doing in here with a hammer?
Oh my God.
Sean Locke is an absolute murderer.
I've been really lucky to, I've supported Sean on a couple of nights, Work in Progress up in like near Barrow and Furness Way. And I've done some work with Lee a few weeks back, which I really can't talk about. But
what a fucking belt.
The body position and everything. I really got something.
Literally walks in here and then 3 minutes later he's like, I'm lying down and that's an edit point. What a fucking pro. That's how you play the O2. Supported.
It's because I've been driving for the last like 4 hours.
Oh, well, just welcome. Relax, mate.
You're
no,
at home,
it's
babe.
Nice, yeah.
You're
it's
at home,
nice.
Babe.
So it's just, but Terry was one of those ones where I bet he was absolutely lovely to you as well, wasn't he? Like at that gig. Like,
what? And obviously, he'd just seen me basically put a 4 out of 10 into the fucking weeds.
Yeah.
And he was dead nice. He was, don't worry about it, mate. It's all right. Yeah, he's honest, and then it was like,
yeah, it's like, see, I remember seeing Terry, like, for the, I saw him, a friend of mine was like, look, you need to watch this guy called Terry Alderton. I was like, what? But I was like, he's on YouTube. He's got it's from like one of the comedy clubs in London. It's obviously like him doing like the store. It was a clip of him. It's only like 10, 12 minutes long, but it's just incredible. And it kind of like just sums up what Terry does. I was like, that's the guy from London's Burning. I'm a massive fire engine nerd. I love fire engines.
You know
so
what?
Much. Fire engine nerd.
You're a massive fire engine nerd.
Yeah.
I've never heard those words put in the same sentence.
If you'd have asked me when you went, you know what, to just guess even like loosely where you were going with that, I'm a massive fire engine nerd. Like, what are we? Are you for real?
Is it a sexual thing or just like?
That'd be weird, mate. Like, for example, like I've only got one of bits on me at the moment, but like, this is my wallet.
Is a fire engine,
it's made out of recycled fire hose. genuinely, yeah. I'd pass it over.
So you're a cathedral nerd,
oh, yeah.
And a fire engine nerd.
Yeah, and I got a girlfriend.
And you've got a girlfriend now. Yeah.
So that my wash bag that's in me Range Rover outside, that's got that's made out of recycled fire hose. I can't remember where I was going with this.
Did you park the Range Rover before you drove around in your Peugeot 206?
What are you on about? That's to get, you know, you have a super yacht and then you get the boat that goes to the dock. That's what I parked the Range Rover outside the business park and then I just brought this in. It's actually a Volvo V40R design.
R design, you're such a nonce. Yeah. Terry Alderton.
What was I talking about?
Terry Alderton, fire. London's burning.
I was obsessed with London's burning.
Everyone's smoking weed today.
I was obsessed with London's burning because I love fire engines, still do, actually, to be fair. And I've got a bit of me, yeah, anyway. So I remember, oh, it's him. And I was like, he used to present the National Lottery with Lulu. I was like, I love this guy. And then went and saw him and I was like, this is the best thing in the world. Like, it's absolutely insane. And because I always do, like, my weird impressions, he kind of, like, took me under his wing and, like, the singing stuff. And Terry's just been amazing since. He's just, like, an absolute inspiration. I love him. And I always kind of, whenever I'm writing stuff, going, what would Terry do in this situation? And, like, the
smash
answer is, like,
the
do something
off
that
it.
You could never fucking think of. But
is that clip from, did he do a half-hour Comedy Store mini special? Because
I've seen the video. It's just store camera stuck to the ceiling.
And, you know, on that store camera, when you listen back to it, there's not that much laughter, really.
Because it's from
there?
The mic.
But on this one, you know he's done well because there's so much laughter. It's kind of on par. And you only really know that once you've asked for your own clip from Graham.
Yeah.
Hey, can I get the DVD? It's an extra fiver. Okay, mate. Yeah, and so, but he's doing so well that you can actually hear the laughs. And it's like, oh.
Those half hours are amazing. Peter Kay, McIntyre, Mickey Flanagan.
Flanagan's great, yeah.
They're some of the best stand-up. Before those guys went, the Comedy Store were like, these guys are murderers. And they just before they went, the Peter Kay one is...
There should be so many more. There should be Comedy Club headliner specials.
They're on YouTube, aren't they?
You can find them.
Fuck me.
I want to touch on something you sort of mentioned before, which is like, you know, when Teddy's like amazing routines don't go that well. Because you sing on stage, right? Because you've got an absolute bastard of a voice, a very good one. But does that ever just not get anything?
Every now and then, it's like, every now and then.
Look, I love you, but I'd fucking love to see that.
Yeah.
I'm a former chorister as well. Just because he nonces around.
A former what?
Chorister. Is that the word?
Former. What, former?
He's a former chorister.
Yeah, chorister.
It sounds like something that, it sounds like someone who does something with dead bodies, that?
A chorister.
I'm a chorister. That's
a coroner.
Yeah, but they're similar.
No, they're not.
Just and they're both coroners and coroners.
Nana's dead. Go and see the chorister. The bitch is dead.
I mean, to be fair, choristers and coroners have both seen a lot of naked men, to be fair.
Oh, there you go.
Thank you.
I sang over it, but you waited perfectly. You found the gap, and that's
there
four runs, sir.
Thank you very much. It's an easy four.
It makes me annoyed that you are getting, because you've got like a proper voice. Like I had, you know, in terms of singing for choirs, you know when people played for United and then there's people like, I had trials for United. He has literally, at his level, like semi-pro, I basically had trials for Oldham Athletic. That's where I'm at in the chorister scheme of things.
Pro, not semi-pro.
Oh, sorry, pro. Played the O2. Have you sung in the O2?
Have I sung in the O2, mate? I got a standing ovation in the O2.
For singing.
Well, it's in the set, isn't it, mate?
And Lichfield Cathedral.
Oh, this ham's really amazing, this pizza, but it's a pizza that's amazing, isn't it? That's not a great analogy, but keep it in. They'll like it. I've sung, and they've not, like, and it's... I've sung before, and I sing like three or four things, like as like a, if I'm doing club sets, it's kind of like there's a few things I do, and I've sung before, and they've just not applauded. I go, and I've just gone, what the fuck? Like, I've James gone, Because I'm like going, nah, you're wrong. You're wrong here. Like, get clapping. Get And I've done it a couple of times. I've done it once where I was supporting Rob Beckett on tour and they just didn't clap at the end of it. And all I could hear was just him in the wings absolutely pissing themselves. Where I'm going, right, you're fucking clapping, all of you. All fucking 1,000 of you. Start clapping. It was just like...
So when you've done the big performance and then you're like, and I pause for applause. Yeah. Nothing. Awkward.
It works as well. Because I'm not very sort of rollicking on stage. My routines tend to be sort of... at their own pace. But when you see a stand-up who does like a really ranty bit, that when they've written it, they're like, and they're expecting everyone to go, oh my God, that was so... The way he said that really well in that order, that was so fun. It was the speed and everything. And when it gets, you can just see the comic just be like, not tonight then.
Yeah, we can see the comic going, that's taken me so long to learn how to do that. Like, because it is a kind of like blah, blah, blah. I never have any of those bits.
I've got the nursery bit about going to Popcats, and I do basically, I become a musical comedian for that bit of thing.
Yeah.
I've got to the end of that bit.
Are you going
to
bring your youth back out for that?
Fuck off. I got to the end of that bit. If no one claps, you've given it everything. I've had my little mantis shake. I've done a whole three songs and they're like, that was all right. And you're like, okay, I've got to catch my breath because you're meant to be clapping now. And you just look a fucking numpty.
Yeah.
You just get on with it, don't you? There's a number of reasons why. And again, it was like going back on to, not to keep banging on about that episode, but where you talk about people like open micers who have been going for years who are doing rubbish and then they get one decent gig and it's like, they're like, oh my God, it's worked. It's the other way around for that. There's no reason why that hasn't worked. It's just for whatever.
Just happens.
Like, it's the bit's still good. And it's just, but it's so funny when, like, you go, oh, that usually kills. But I used to panic, but now I'm like going, I'm going to have a really nice sandwich on the way home.
That's experience, though, isn't it? It's experience. If you want it too hard, yeah. I don't think it helps.
Yeah.
I think no one wants to be so laid back they're not arsed at all. But as a comic, it really helps you professionally if you give a shit, but not too much. The open spots were like, they're living every up and down too much, and it becomes like...
Once you've been going for a certain amount of time, like there's routines I've got where I'm like, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, but the routines and what you're talking about, they're show pieces that really fucking murder. I do just have an attitude with the audience at times. If I do a bit that I know is a solid fucking bit and has worked in comedy clubs in every fucking town in the country, the Edinburgh Festival, and then on tour, and then a room of 100 people go, no, I'm just like, I don't care. You're all wrong. There's no way every other audience is wrong, and it's either they are or you are. So fuck yourselves. I'm never coming back to Coventry.
But with that, I just have to go, well, they're wrong. I just internalize, like, well, they're wrong. Do you know what I mean? But I'm not going to, you know, they might not know that they're wrong. They might go, huh? What? You know, they just might not have seen comedy before. But there's certain mechanisms that you get in place once you've been going for a while that you learn how to deal with certain things. It's like the Millikan's Law. You have a bad gig, like 11 o'clock the next day, you forget about it. And it's like, if something's not working out, you go, oh, I'm going to have a nice drive home tonight. Oh,
yeah, it's a self-defense mechanism.
See my family when I get home. And so you just kind of pull yourself together. If you're doing that every night, if every night you're going, okay, Millikan's Law, oh God, I'm going to have a night, you're going, well, something's gone wrong here. Do you know what I mean? If it was once every 40 or 50 gigs, but if every night you're having to do every single coping mechanism because the gigs aren't working, the jokes aren't working, and you're essentially crying, then
if at minute 15 of every set you do, you have to go, oh, well, at least I've got heated seats in the Volvo.
I have.
Change your set. Of course you have. Our design, isn't it?
And car
B40.
I don't like being warm in a car.
You
like being cool. Drives in mad when cars drive me round. I have a cold in the car. Like
it opens
cool.
All the windows on the motorway.
I don't.
This is back to the thing about people who can't judge the fucking temperature. What do you mean?
It's like being cool.
So but you like being like dangerous, like on the motorway.
Speaking of temperature, my temperature's been really low every time I get zapped when I go into a restaurant. 35.7 or 35.9.
You're as cold as ice.
Mine's low as well.
Does anyone find it intimidating have a bouncer who are usually cunts put something up against your head in a fucking gun motion and be like, sorry, lads, got to just do this. You're like,
what are you worried about?
They don't give a shit.
How do I know that's not a fucking gun?
Have you seen No Country for Old Men when he's got the cattle fucking killer?
No.
No.
No, but
I don't know. I know it's not going to happen. I just don't like the thing of a bouncer going, let me just do that on you. Yeah, you're all right.
He didn't actually press it against you. It's about a foot away. But like, and also,
do they not kiss you?
No, and also it's, you just know it's a thermometer, so I don't know why you're going, oh, it could be a gun. I was like,
but well, then, and
got,
then
where's
they go,
he got a gun from during the pandemic?
Right.
Oh, yeah, yeah. The gun market has crashed.
Mate, guns are well COVID safe. You can stay 2 metres away and murk someone. Yeah. Knives? Fucking ridiculous. Rishi Sunak's not about knifings.
Yeah, fair enough.
Great banter. Keep that one in.
Rishi Sunak. Keep. Is that the catchphrase for this?
No, I just.
If we titled episodes, it would be keep that in.
I just bin one into the fucking wall. And everyone's like. I'd rather just own it and be like, that was shit banter, Dan. It's time to make a joke. Hey, but, better hey,
Dan,
than that.
Dan, heated seats though. Heated seats later on.
That was a good laugh, wasn't it? There you go. That was like, honestly, on the drive to Nottingham in a bit, I'd be like, yeah, that one was shit, but there was a few other good ones.
Are you in Nottingham tonight, are you?
I'm going to East Midlands meet, do you know what I mean? Fucking playing Nottingham. It's a COVID hotspot. I'm staying in the Hilton. MI5. There's a man coming in, looks like a nonce.
Daryl's gig?
No.
Okay, cool.
The other one. The other place.
The Glee Club.
I'm going to the Glee Club. It's the first weekend away with a hotel that I've had since what? February?
Yeah.
And it feels good. My wife accused me of having an affair. I was like, I just want to lie in.
How much time between getting your key card for your room?
Yeah, I know where this is going.
And the time of your dick being in your hand.
Oh,
are you going to have a shout wank?
With a towel in his hand.
I've not packed the cream.
What?
Oh.
What cream? What do you mean, cream?
My wanking cream.
Oh, this is not the podcast I signed up to.
It is.
Is it not?
It is.
It truly is. I don't think you listened to all of that episode. Have you never done that? You never done that? Have you never gone on an away fixture and thought, I'm going to crack one out and I don't want to go bareback?
No.
And then you think about shower gel.
Cream.
And
you're
like, I have a little.
Not lube. Not baby oil.
I ran out of lube and I've got
baby
some.
Baby oil?
I've got some.
Baby oil's great.
For what? Babies?
No. For your dick?
What? Why are you looking like that, Carl? What do you use? Butter? Utterly.
What's that?
You lot are disgusting.
We're making a living from this.
How?
I've got a bit of aloe vera moisturiser. That's a little treat myself right. No, don't look at me like I'm mental.
What's the difference?
It's just a moisturiser.
Do you put pre-roll ads in these videos?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. And at the end as well.
Yeah.
That is interesting. So I've got a YouTube channel. It's only each video is only 3 minutes long, so I can only put some at the beginning. But
are you doing enough wanking stuff?
No.
That's how you get the money in. Sponsors come for that.
Has anyone looked more relaxed than Lloyd Griffith did when he just rolled in it? It's amazing. I love to see it.
It was the way that it was positioned. It was almost like, oh, do you mind laying down?
I am so happy.
I was like, because I've seen people up that end, I've seen people here, and I've just thought, if I'm here, then I've got you there, I've got the camera there. I've done a bit of TV in my time, you know what I mean? So I know
angles. I can tell.
And so I just think this is like the best. You know, if I need to have a little, that's the equivalent of a side glance, you know what I mean?
You've nailed it.
Like a flea bag or, you know, like a, or, you know, so it's.
Yeah.
He took one look at the room and he was like, no, I know where I need to be. So our second guest in the row was laid down. Steph Johnson laid down.
Steph Johnson. Okay.
Steph Johnson.
I'll have a word with her or him.
Should we have a, so weird, talking about interval breaks, shall we have a little mid-roll on this?
Who was talking about interval breaks?
Oh, I talked about mid-rolls.
He did talk about mid-rolls. Yeah. It was a segue.
You want to do a little?
Nutella for wanking.
Yeah.
Cha.
Upset me.
Spanish Nutella.
Mama like that.
Okay. What's happening, guys? Do us a favour. Only take you 2 seconds. Leave a like on this video. Go and subscribe to our channel and ring the bell if you haven't done that already. A little comment. All these things help us with the YouTube algorithms. We'd be very, very grateful. It'll take you 2 seconds. Got to do it now. And then we'll get back to the pod. Go ahead.
What's your favourite Christmas carol? Just before we crack on to the... Adam's done some prep. As chorister to chorister. What are you saying to Bleak Midwinter? I like Bleak Midwinter. You've got to show some restraint with
it. It's in the
Bleak Midwinter. Come on, I've got some pipes.
Yeah, so like Coventry Carol or Coventry Carol is like a decent one. I'm talking, these are quite niche, though, yeah.
Kind of fucking Christmas songs, are these?
Have
you never heard In the Bleak Midwinter
or
before?
Or once in Royal David City.
Like, Jingle Bell Rock.
Yeah, but he'd do it all like Scouse, like, once in Royal fucking David City, stood in arms, we burnt his house down.
Are you a baritone, Lloyd?
No, he's a tenor.
I'm a baritone. For
Step into Christmas.
That's a song, mate.
It's a Christmas song.
The darkness. Yeah, it's a Christmas song. It's not a Christmas carol.
What's the difference?
Are we recording?
Yeah.
Wow. How is this
keep
making
it
money?
Keep it in.
Fucking hell.
What's the difference between a carol and a song?
What?
What
a,
is
a Christmas
the
carol? Because it's all Christian and Nancy. That's a carol.
Can we not like Elton John Nancy with this? Or yeah. I feel like
in the bleak midwinter. No, you don't have
step
that.
Step into Christmas.
That's
we
that's
can
like
watch the snowfall forever and ever.
What but kind of Catholic school did
jingle
you go to?
Jingle bell, rock.
How scouse is that? Right, we're going to have a Christmas carol. We're going to go put Home Alone on the fucking soundtrack.
Driving on for Christmas is the one, though, isn't it?
Okay, I mean, you need, sorry, not to, but you need to do a little bit of education around this. So you're singing songs that are quite popular songs, which, you know, I don't mind.
Christmas songs.
I don't mind a bit of Wizard every now and then, or a bit of Slade.
Slade.
But these are Christmas carols, are carols that are carolled, okay, so that's the correct term, they're carolled in churches and around towns, okay? So these are all, like, ancient stuff, so talking about the birth of baby Jesus.
When I was a kid, though, we sang All I Want for Christmas Is You by Mariah Carey in church.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, a lot of questions there. And I doubt you got a very good Ofsted rating, mate, to be fair.
But outstanding. The church was part of the school ground, St. Margaret Mary's, and yeah, we sang a few of your little Jesus ones, and then they went, actually, let's get Mariah Carey on, and they played a CD player, just one CD player, and the whole church, full of the whole year, sang All I Want for Christmas Is You by Mariah Carey. So is that now a Christmas carol?
No.
Why?
Because I'm not sure that's definitely a church you were in. I think it might have been your Uncle Jeff's house.
If you've basically got like a nativity scene and you're aiming that at the baby Jesus in the cradle, All I Want for Christmas Is You, then I guess you can get away with it. Do you know what I mean? But ultimately, these are songs, the carols are songs that are around the nativity.
He's not enjoying this, is he?
No, but I just
got to be done properly.
Certain things, if like if you called a fire engine, I go, well, that's it's a fire appliance. You know what I mean? It's not actually a fire engine.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Like, it's a fireman. It's a firefighter, actually. It's 2020,
you get sex
dickheads.
With girls.
But with like proper choral music and stuff like that, I do get a little bit. It's fun to have a joke, but can we just have a little bit of separation here? Is that okay?
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Mariah Carey's, your Slades, your Wizards, your Chris Rea's, all that lot. They go into the Christmas songs, Christmas carols, Once in Royal David City, Away in a Manger, In the Bleak Midwinter,
The Pogues.
King Went song, because it was, if it's got a YouTube video, it's in the song category, okay?
Really?
No, okay, so don't be a dickhead, obviously. Yeah.
What about every now and then?
I'd say pre-1900s, carol, post-1900s, song.
What changed in the 1900s? What was the big thing?
Well, people just stopped believing in Jesus, didn't they? And God and all that lot.
What about Shine, Jesus, Shine? Where do you stand on that? Oh. Is that a modern carol?
It's not really for me.
Oh, no, it's just a church song, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just a church song. But yeah, it's fine, yeah.
I really I love how, of all the things we took the piss out of, that was the one who was like, there's the line, lads.
Yeah.
There's the fucking line.
So I think
official video, Away in a Manger.
I mean, you
Away in a Manger.
Okay, so the YouTube thing was actually like, obviously, what I'm saying is, oh, God. Like, well, that's not the original melody, is it?
No, he's gone freestyle on this. Gone,
this is absolutely ridiculous.
This is weird.
That's no.
So that's not a carol anymore.
It's a carol because it's still a carol, yeah.
But he's bastardized it.
Yeah, but he's used his own or their own melody to do that.
Jesus was a bastard.
Jesus was a goth, according
to
you.
Jesus was the OG.
Let's get this back on the tracks. That was my fault. I just thought you'd be like, yeah, like this one. And apparently it was just a big argument about fucking carols. I'd love to have seen your nativity. Like, hey, lads, a fucking priest in an Everton top. Come on! Fucking Christmas here, kids! Hey, I tell you this, fucking Herod was a Tory.
Do you know what, though? Seriously, like, I know you're all into these songs and that because it's your job and that, but wouldn't Christmas carolers knocking at your house be more welcome if they sang some of the good songs?
Like what?
What are the good songs?
Mariah Carey, The Pogues.
The Darkness.
The Darkness.
No, but
I believe in a thing called love.
But I'm going to put my foot down. No, No, because that's a song for a band, and like, you know, it's a different style. Whereas if you had four or eight or 16 carolers turn up your door doing a lovely four part harmony of Once in Royal David City, that's lovely. That's traditional. That's nice. If you've got someone doing a karaoke version of All I Want for Christmas, I'd be like, what are you doing, you lunatic?
No, I'm not saying just fucking your Auntie Joan knocks at the door and like, I'm going to sing a song. I'm talking eight, like crowd. I love a bit of crowd singing. So like 16 kids turn up at your house and they're like, one, two, three, four, step into Christmas.
Did you just do it? You just did Oh my God. He did it without even thinking. He went back to childhood, primary school, counting the rhythm like, and a finger.
I normally, if the carolers knock, I'm always like, yay, and I get them halfway through and I'm like, oh, here's a quid, fuck off, right? But if they were singing the Pogues, I'd give them a note and I wouldn't I wouldn't shut the door.
So scarce when he gets
I feel like
Lloyd's got nothing. He's like,
I feel like carolers could be making more money if they actually were doing some actual tunes instead.
Yeah, well, I'm a caroler, mate, and I've got a Range Rover. All right, keep that in. I used to love
and a Volvo.
So, what's your favourite carol?
I'm going to say Once in Royal David City. Just to,
nice. Great. Sorry, that was my fault. Not sorry.
What a gig.
I've got some would you rathers for you. Is that alright?
I love them.
Yeah. You ready?
Yes.
So, got four. So, see, we might only do a couple. But I know you're a big sport guy, aren't you?
Yeah.
14 mainly.
Yeah.
Are you a Grimsby?
Yeah.
Town fan? Yeah.
How are they doing?
Not very well. We haven't played for the last 2 weeks because we got COVID and we're second bottom of the league. So, all in all, not ideal.
Great start to the season. Three lads are dead and we're fucking 4 points off the bottom.
Do you have like a second team that you follow? Like a big team?
So, when I was growing up, I used to go to... Because my mum used to work Saturdays. So, it was cheaper for me to go with my cousin to Old Trafford on a Saturday with a £9...
I knew it was going to be United.
...adult ticket.
Yeah.
...than it was for me to... For mum to pay for a babysitter. So... I had a penchant for Peter Schmeichel, which then resulted in me going to see Man United for like two seasons.
You're so just a bit of a Schmeichel fan?
Yeah, I love Peter Schmeichel. Like, obsessed with Peter Schmeichel. And fire engines. Fire appliances. God,
you're so on the spectrum, it's amazing.
And cathedrals, yeah. But, yeah.
Have you ever had a dream about Peter Schmeichel being a fireman? 100%.
Being a fireman? No. I've had a dream about Peter Schmeichel doing certain things to me, like getting me over his shoulder and stuff like that.
Rescuing fireman.
Like a firefighter, yeah.
If you're going to have a jolly onto the gay side of things, it's not with Peter Schmeichel, is it? Great lump of a Danish goalkeeper.
You know that thing where
he's massive, he's blonde.
Oh my God.
There's absolutely no way he hasn't got an absolute weapon.
Oh my God. He's going to spin you on his dick, Adam. That's exactly how that'll go down.
Yeah.
You're the bottom with Peter Schmeichel, you know.
Yeah.
What? He's getting his dick out.
Your dentist stringing me.
Your dentist stringing you.
Hello? It is, yeah. Could I give you a call back in a bit? I'm just in the middle of recording something. Thank you. Bye.
Oh, she
leave that in.
Nice.
Don't.
Was that a subtle spawn there? Is it going to come up like, Adam's dentist is smile for
you? Dental on Allerton Road can provide you with an Invisalign. Get the smile you've always craved for just £3,000 and upwards.
You want Peter Schmeichel to fancy you.
Would you rather never be able to watch sport again or only be able to watch sport, no other form of entertainment?
Never watch sport again.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
How about you?
What can you classify all the other entertainment and I'll make a decision?
So you can still listen to music, but you can't watch the music channel.
Why?
Well, that's easy.
No, Phil, because then you'd be watching it. You can't watch any other form of entertainment. You can't watch films. You can't watch TV shows.
You can still listen to podcasts.
Yeah. Any visual entertainment is gone.
What about sports movies?
Nope.
The theatre. Oh, nope. That's gone anyway. I can't watch the ballet anymore.
Nope.
For shame.
You can't watch any dog fighting.
Right. Okay, good. Let's not talk about your nativity again. I think because I can listen to podcasts and I can hear like radio, I might have to keep sport.
I'd definitely keep sport.
But you wouldn't.
So you can't watch TV again?
Nope.
You can't go to a concert, a gig?
Nope. Never been to one anyway.
How much comedy?
You haven't been to a music gig in your life?
Nope. I've been in like a pub and someone's got a guitar out.
So you've never been to like bought a ticket to see?
I bought a ticket to see the Spice Girls, but no one had come with me.
I went last year.
Yeah, I was meant to go.
I got another story. I'll come on and tell you 2 years once the NDAs run out about Spice Girls concert. Jesus Christ.
How are you not telling it now?
Because the NDA.
I thought you said MDMA. I was like, is everyone on drugs?
He's fucking off his bonk.
I'll tell you when the MDMA wears off.
But you've never been to see... who do you listen to? Like when you listen to it on Spotify? Or like, what
it's not good.
To?
It's not good.
I've got a real eclectic taste. Eminem.
Pre-2003.
Bewitched. Tupac. Oasis. Of Monsters and Men. Kings of Leon. Pink.
She's like... Burton's
Shakira.
Yeah.
Playlist.
This is literally like co-op radio, isn't it?
It's Arcadia Radio.
Yeah, okay, Kelly.
We need a... What?
Not anymore.
We need a little bit for Topshop, a bit for Dorothy Perkins, a bit for Burton's. It's like, you know, you've gone, oh, let's listen to Adams. Oh, yeah, we can splice that up. But yeah, no, like I love going to live...
Hamilton
like,
soundtrack.
Oh, I went to see Hamilton.
Oh. Keeping on the tracks, guys.
Hated it.
Fucking hell.
Really?
Really enjoy it.
Hamilton. Don't say that.
But yeah, so for me, it's like, I love sport, and I love so many different sports, but there's so many other things that I do enjoy that I just like.
Here's my playlist called Favourites. Now, I haven't listened to this one in a while, but this is from about 2 or 3 years ago. And this is, look, I'm not making this up. This is real. So it's Skinny Love by Birdie. When You Say Nothing At All by Ronan Keating.
Jesus.
Say La Vie by Bewitched. Bring It All Back by S Club 7. Hard Knock Life by Jay-Z. Ghetto Gospel by Tupac. Burn by Usher. Little Talks of Monsters and Men. Raise Your Glass by Pink. Breathe by Sean Poil. Lose Yourself by Eminem. Till I Collapse by Eminem featuring Nate Dogg. Sing for the Moment by Eminem. Royals Live by Lord. Forever The Wire and Honey and I by Haim. 1 Week by the Bare Naked Ladies. Ray Charles by Chitty Bang. Airplanes Part 2 featuring Eminem and B.O.B. from Hayley Williams. It Hurts
it's
So
like
Good
the
from
last
the Lumen
10 years iTunes. Hasn't happened. What happened, Adam? Did your
Happy.
iTunes just not update?
Happy by Pharrell. Place Your Hands by Reef. How Do I Live by Liam Rimes. Can't Fight the Moonlights by Liam Rimes.
All right, we get it. We
All
get
About
it.
That
we get
Face
it.
By
we
Meghan Trainor.
You're fucking out of fashion. It's literally like a special CD called Now That's What I Call
Say It Again
Shit
by
Your
Precious.
Nana Likes.
Say it again. Say yeah. Say the words out.
So it's easy for him to give up music.
Yeah,
well
that's, that, yeah. I mean, that's understandable. You've got a really bad palate. If you don't mind me saying so.
But when you're a Grimsby fan, is it easier to give up sport?
Well, you asked me to give up all sport there, aren't you?
Yes. Yeah.
So yeah, it's not easy to do that.
What's your other penchant when it
I like
comes to
everything.
Sport?
I go to the boxing quite a lot. I go to...
Really?
Go
who,
to the
O2. Who did you last see fight?
Oh, who did I last see fight? It might have been... Either one of Chisora or Dillian White fights.
Wembley?
Or O2? O2, yeah.
So must have been weird, like, Lloyd, you were only here last week playing it. Keep that in.
You know what? I know the place.
Did you support the fight?
Yeah, I was.
Guys, I know you're here for boxing, but have you ever heard duct tape?
Right, honestly, I supported someone. I was a ring person, okay? All right? I wasn't
a
ring
it's
girl.
It's 2020. You can be anything you want to be.
I was
be,
a
babe.
Ring person, just going round, yeah. But yeah, so I go, me and Rob Beckett go to boxing quite a lot, and I go with his brother to this Ultimate Fighter one as well, which is just like a knockout where like a boxer has to fight 3 times in one evening, where it's insane.
Oh, it's like shorter fights, and then it's almost like they do quarter
stays
final, semi final.
Yeah,
is it winner stays on?
It's not winner stays on, so it's done so that you get a bit of breathing time. Then in the, they have like a half an hour break where they'll just have like a show fight on. And so, like, Granit Xhaka was
I
there.
I think there might be a market for that, you know, winner stays on fighting.
Well, it's just bare-knuckle fighting, that, isn't it, really?
Yeah. But
I thought you were going to say winner stays on comedy.
But you wouldn't be able to have winner stays on because it's just, it'd be so unfair. Because someone would have had a 7-minute breathing space, which makes such a massive difference.
Yeah, they have, like,
boxing,
basically...
Right?
Like,
you can give them a little 5 minutes, have a Ribena, and get yourself ready for round for the next one.
Yeah.
It doesn't work, does it? Because the last guy to fight has got a really good chance of winning the whole thing. You know, Dave that's just sat there. These lads are fucking knackering themselves out.
You just say, like, to win, you have to win, like, 8 in a row.
Right. This this is what they're doing is a quarterfinals, a semis, a finals, with show fights in the middle. And the night, you've got, like, a prize fighter at the end, haven't you?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's great. Yeah,
and he wins a contract and wins, I think it was, like, 50 grand or something. So we went and saw that at the Indigo in the O2. Yeah, I go to quite a bit. Been to York Hall a couple of times in Bethnal Green. Watched a few fights there. But
what's the atmosphere like? I've literally never. I like fighting, but
at the O2, it's and we've been looking. What? I like fighting.
I've never done it. I'm a massive fucking pussy.
From someone who just doesn't understand any of combat sports. No, I like fighting when they hit each other. And you know,
I remember back in the day.
It's a weird one because it depends who's fighting and what the following's like. Because you can, you know, if there's a bit of a hearty following, then it can get a bit tasty in the crowd. I've always been lucky in that I've either always been ringside or not literally, but like, you know, within that block or in a box. But it's fun. It's like, yeah, it's, you know, it's you enjoy it. It's tasty.
I would like to go to see a fight, like if we can.
A fight?
What do you mean? Why is that? That's not the wrong terminology, is it?
You
go and see a fight.
It just sounds weird.
Yeah, I went to one of the. I got so drunk at a fight once. It was at the O2. I think it was Takan and there's me going. Oh yeah, I love boxing, but I can't remember what the fight was.
Two blokes.
You
mean
like
mainly
being in a room and shouting at people while they're punching each other?
Yeah, so I like going to junglers gigs. very niche, but. Yeah, I got so pissed. And there's two brothers called the McDonald brothers who are from Doncaster, I think that's right. And one of them basically just kept free pouring vodka into my drink without me really realising. That was a bit of fun. And I was just so drunk. You know Michael Buffer, the "Let's get ready to rumble!"
Producer's brother.
I was so drunk, he went to bed. I was chatting to him in like the after party thing. And he went, "Okay, so I'm going to go to bed now."
He doesn't talk like that away from the mic.
Honestly, it's like, he's so American. It's like, "Okay, Lloyd, well, I'm going to go to bed now." I was like,
"Let's get ready."
See you later. And I was so drunk. I had to text Tony Bellew the next day to apologise. I got, "Hey, mate, do I need to apologise for anything? Because like, I don't remember getting home or anything." He's like, "Mate, you were just on the cusp, mate, but fucking hell, you were funny." I was like, "Okay, phew," because you don't really want to piss Tony Bellew off because he doesn't hold back.
Yeah.
And he'll let you know. But yeah, Tony.
So you're going to remove all of this from your life just to watch what? Breaking Bad again?
Not Breaking Bad, to go and listen to. I'm a big, mate, because I've got a degree in music. And so, like, I'm a big.
Still listen to it?
Yeah, you can still listen to it, but I love to go and watch stuff. Theatre, opera.
I tell you what though, if you meet someone, Laura would be fucking fuming if I was like, "Sorry, love, we can't watch anything tonight, film, TV, or anything."
If she loves, yeah,
I don't know, would you rather? But we can watch
nothing.
We can watch like Real Sociedad on Sky Sports. She'll be fucking fuming. "Tuesday night, let's watch a film." We can't. Come on, love, they're away at Oviedo. What do you mean you're leaving me?
Gives me the feeling like a Liverpool win, especially a big win. Like, I've never felt like had the feelings when Liverpool beat Barcelona 4-0 to overturn that 3-0 deficit. There's not a film or TV show that can possibly match that feeling.
Yeah.
So I'm not giving up sport.
Yeah. But it's not meant to, is it? You know, you don't get to the end of Breaking Bad like, God, he's really invested in the season finale.
I get that. And I've had quite a similar one when Grimsby overcame a 1-0 deficit to Braintree in the playoff semi-final for the National League. You know what I mean? Omar Bogle and Porrick Hammond. You know what I mean? But still, I think I do want to see.
Like, I've never nearly broke me back over an episode of EastEnders. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Whereas when Origi made it 2-0 in Madrid, fucking near killed myself, mate.
That was a great goal, that Origi.
Great. I would like to see a fight, though. I think that's the terminology. If we could
a punch job,
you get decent fights at MEN when everything can go back to normal, or like at the
looking forward to it.
MEN or the M&S Direct Arena. I've played them all.
Jesus Christ! What's the next one?
Would you rather be able to smell human shit every second of every day, or once a day you have to smell the armpit of a passerby, but it's a proper deep inhale, like a. Like, you know, it's right in here.
I wish everyone could have just got what I got.
Right? But you can never explain what you're doing to the stranger. So, constant shite, human shite. And you know the difference between human and dog shit. It's different. You just know when
rich.
It's human.
It's
or, once a day, without explaining it, and COVID's gone, so you're not worried about distancing and that. You just got to get yourself.
Go on, do a little test on me now.
I've just done it. I don't want to do it again.
I'm pretty fresh.
It feels like you haven't really thought that through. Like the armpit, 100%.
Such an obvious answer.
Is it?
Yeah. I mean, you are probably going to get punched in the face occasionally.
No, just pick an old woman.
No, you don't get to. You don't get to pick. Doesn't it just a red light go
either
up
way? It's a short part of your life that you just got to deal with it, and you know it's going to happen. But to smell that smell every single day, every single
horrible.
Second.
Horrible. Do you not think you get used to it though? Like people who live in farmland.
I don't think you. But the thing is, though, in this situation,
farmland.
I don't think you need to get used to it. If you can just go, I'll just sniff an armpit for 5 seconds.
Also, armpits less offensive to me than crotches. Sometimes breath. I would honestly, if someone said, you've got to right now sniff my pit or sniff my fingers.
Oh my God.
Fingers are dirty.
Yeah, someone's breath. If you said someone's breath, I'd be like, that'd be a dilemma. But the armpit, easy. And have you heard of deodorant?
Yeah.
That solves most things now.
Yeah.
It's always the armpits of someone who works in CEX.
Oh, that's not fair, is it? Right. But at least they've got the plexiglass. Surrounded by Game Boys and...
Are we really saying that it's hate speech to say that people who work in CEX occasionally have a bow problem?
I think it's awful.
Do you?
Next one.
Good luck trying to trade in your FIFA 2019, mate.
Would you rather constantly be closed lips smiling like that or constantly be resting bitch face? They stay that way regardless of what your actual emotions are.
Smiling.
It's a bit creepy, though, isn't it?
Don't matter.
Your mum's dead.
Yeah. Yeah. What if you see a car crash and you go over and they're like, there's bodies everywhere. Someone ring the police, ring an ambulance. You're like...
Exactly.
But the thing is, though, that's not my problem. Because they're just like, they've got to look at it and they'll be like, he's weird. I'll be like, no, I'm trying to... Hey, yeah. Can you call the ambulance? Ambulance, please. You know what I mean? I'm not bothered. Like, I don't have to... I'd have to see that, apart from when I'm brushing my teeth. Or if it, maybe if I'm, like, sad and I look myself in the mirror, I'm like, what's going on, you fucking freak? But then that's, like, quite rare.
But what if someone, like, breaks down and, like, Lloyd, I've had the test back. And it's pretty bad. I've got 2 months to... Why are you smiling, Lloyd?
Well, you know about the condition.
No, you can't tell anyone.
Oh, yeah.
If someone's... But they've known me for... If someone that close is telling me...
You've got to extend... You.
So what? So that... But you're not thinking any of these through, Adam. I'm really sorry, mate. But that person...
I love it when people get into them. Like, that's ridiculous.
But that person who has felt compelled to tell me that they've got such a bad, you know, situation in their life, there's a reason why they're telling me that. Do you know what I mean? Presumably friends, lover, family. Do you know what I mean? Therefore, this isn't the first time we've met. So they know about that. So that's fine. It's only in situations where, you know...
strangers.
I've just been mugged. Guys, can you help me? I've just been mugged. And they're going, what? You know, that's the situation where it's a bit weird. But then again, he's just having to explain himself as opposed to...
No, not it's not resting up their face.
I fucking hate in a crowd when you're having a good night and then there's just some fucking punter with a fucking face like a slapped arse, like... And it is resting.
Would you rather that or just
awful?
Or just that's my, like, no matter what you're doing, you're ripping it. Would you rather that? That's more disconcerting.
You look a bit simple.
When we did the Jonathan Ross show and they made everyone in the audience wear a mask with a smile on it.
It throws you.
It was fucking terrifying. Let me tell you right now, you don't want a room full of people just.
I saw it.
Rob came up and went, just say no, the mask throw you. I didn't think they would. He went, I do. So I literally watched people in the masks just for like 10 minutes just to get myself into that. And it's like, you can't, it's a weird situation.
It was a gag. I watched him trying to explain it. Like, this will be funny. And you're like, it wasn't. You should have just left it as masks.
But yeah, even if you've got the masks on, I think you've got to reference it. It's just like, and I think that way they did. It just made it harder for the comedians. But in the end, you've got an edit and that's beautiful. So yeah. It doesn't really matter.
Yeah, keep that.
I'd say smiling. I think it's smiling.
I'd rather have the bitch face, me.
Do you know what as well? And also, and this is really wanky of me, but my whole thing in life is just to make people happy. I know it sounds so, it's like, that is literally all I want to do. Why my stand-up is so, I'm always the butt of the joke. It's always me that's the bell end in it. I don't like taking the mick out of people on stage just because, like, I just want people to be happy. And that is, you know, it goes back to, you know, issues of me just wanting to be loved. But at the same time, it's like, I just want people to be happy. And, like, I will very rarely be nasty to people on stuff or So if you can see someone walking down the road and they're smiling, you automatically feel like, oh, what's he smiling for? Do you know what I mean? So I think that's quite a nice thing to...
Kill three people.
Yeah, yeah, but at least...
I've got away with it.
You've killed three people, but you're walking past, say, 200 people a day and you're making them feel happier. Do you know what I mean? So yeah, on
is.
Average...
Is it worth
you're right.
it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
If
killing... did you just, I loved how you just did that maths, like, three people are dead, but 200 people are smiling.
Is that, that's up. The moral quandary, though, isn't it? Like, if... murdering someone every 6 months makes you a better person.
Oh, it's about murder. He's going to kill someone one day. And no, who's he here with
if
all
you
the
kill
time?
This dickhead. One person every like 6 months, but it makes you a better person to enrich the lives. If you just need it out your system,
yeah,
is that morally acceptable?
Have a word pod at gmail.com if you'd like to get involved.
Is it though?
No.
I love it, how he's like,
you're making more than one person.
Are we actually unhappy? Answering the fucking question?
You make a serious question?
I think legally, no.
I didn't say legally, I said morally.
It's not just the person who dies who's unhappy, you know. They've got mates.
Twice a week. It's my life.
This is what if you just kill lonely people?
How you doing, mate?
I'll do really well.
Sorry.
Should we have a word?
Yeah.
Ready?
It's time to have a word with Adam and Dan. Tell us all the problems you have with your friends. This was gonna be the whole podcast. Now it's just the final 10%.
Oh!
Great Jesus. Carol. Great Carol.
So, gonna give Lloyd the option. So, we've got tattoos.
Have a words are like problem solving. Yeah. Cool.
Reverse agony aunt sort of thing. Tattoos. Dirty neighbour.
Dirty.
Love slaggy auntie.
Dirtying scouse is great. Dirty. Slaggy auntie.
Or new manager.
Let's go with new manager.
Ooh, new manager.
Carl, I like this one.
New manager for three.
Desmond Tutu and Ace Ventura.
Weird.
Very, very creative. Love the podcast and want you to sort my mate Ted out for me. He's recently been promoted to bar manager in work, which is sound, but he's become an absolute bell end and the power has gone to his head. He's gone from being one of the boys to being a bell end who tells us what to do. He's overly nitpicky with menial jobs and he's talking to us like we're beneath him. It's just a joke. He's a casual fan of the podcast and he'll probably hear this, so yeah, have a word with him. His name's Nick.
Oh, we know a Nick.
Nick. Who's a bar manager?
We do.
Also, do you know when I decided exactly how this was going to go, our opinion on it, when I heard casual listener? And I'm like, oh, well, I think I have just come down on one side of this.
What do you reckon?
It's a tough one because obviously Nick has just got a promotion. And especially in this day and age, you know what I mean, with these scary times, you need to be keeping that job. And you need to be showing your line manager that you're doing a good job. So it's always difficult when you have to manage your friends or family.
It is fucking horrible.
It's horrible, yeah. Like, I'm about to get into a situation.
Just we don't really do real advice.
All right, do you not?
No, he's very grown up though.
Offensive opinions. Offensive opinions. Just go again.
Yeah. Nick can go fuck himself.
Yeah, right. You casual nonce.
Is that the kind of thing you want, yeah? Is that right?
Have you ever been a manager? Have you ever been a manager?
Yeah. Well, I had a different... I was a producer for an experiential life marketing agency.
Who did, a what?
Did an experiential life marketing agency who did events globally. So, yeah, I was a manager for a little while, yeah.
Have you ever been promoted at any point?
I got promoted to... What was my job?
You were a supervisor and you were a massive cunt.
I wasn't a massive cunt.
Wow. This is Nick.
But you do have to, I empathise with it a bit because you do get lent on by the people above you, like the bar managers and that. They're like, you're not staff anymore. You have to tell people what to do.
Why is he allowed to give normal advice? I got fucking ripped for it. This is unbelievable.
This is my podcast, mate. So.
But for 50p an hour, you're basically...
He wasn't my supervisor, by the way.
All right. God.
Fuck that.
All right, mate.
Until now, mate.
That's what they do, though, isn't it? The bosses are like, we'll make you a supervisor. Yeah. Come on, you'll get 50p an hour extra.
Pence an hour
and now
extra.
Be an arsehole. 20p.
20p an hour extra. But I just wanted the... I'm a competitive guy, aren't I? I've gone up the list there. I'm climbing the ladder to owning my own bar.
Do you think you'd be a good boss? If this really kicks off and we've got fucking whole production staff, do you think you'd be a dead sound boss?
Yeah. Just do what you fucking told and I won't have to tell you off.
That's exactly what I do.
Oh, that's great.
Just do your cunting job and everything will be fine.
There is a skill to being a sound manager. Yeah. If you can pitch it by going, look, I'm not going to fuck around. Sorry. We've got a job to do.
General manager, thank you.
You need to get the authority right and then also not be an absolute like mini Hitler. Yeah.
I did it where I was friends with the staff and it was like, hey, why are you being a knobhead to me?
That's the way, isn't it?
And you're like, oh, sweet.
It just depends what your demeanour is like as well, because if you seem to be a pushover, then people will push you over. Whereas, I mean, I wouldn't really mess with you in any situation, to be fair, Carl.
Because he's editing it.
Right, he's editing it, yeah. So I think it just depends who you are as well. And Nick, just going back to serious advice, might think, ah, shit, I need to stamp my authority here. It might calm down, but for the time being, just rinse him outside of work. Just rake his life out outside of work.
Yeah. Create a new WhatsApp group.
Yeah.
Don't delete him from the one he's in.
Just
still talking there every now and then. Oh, make a new WhatsApp group and call it like Nick's a twat and talk about something. I get it all out.
That's the worst. That people who do fucking sub
WhatsApp groups. Oh, yeah, but they've got to deal with the dickhead somehow.
Horrible.
None of my mates do sub WhatsApp.
Does someone do that to you?
No, I've seen.
Are you sure?
Maybe they have. Wow, I don't know.
Every time you send me a private message on WhatsApp, although not that genuinely haven't happened, I feel like going, God, what's about to go down here? Why are we not in the like podcast group?
When you got a podcast, is it the three of you in the podcast group?
Yeah. Mm. Just that's cunty, isn't it?
Don't get gel.
That's cute.
Don't get jelly, baby. Can we do Dirty Neighbour as well? I really want to see what Dirty Neighbour was about. Is that possible?
I actually want a tattoo.
Oh, do you? I mean, it's guest.
But it's your podcast.
No.
Yeah, no, but to be fair,
no, guest preference.
Side and vote.
What is it?
Dirty Neighbour or tattoo?
Tattoo.
Yeah, it's right.
Coming in your head.
Is that the song?
Sure.
All the things I said.
The lesbian one, that was great when we were in school.
Yeah, they've just come out. You should check them out. They'll be right up your street. It's a fresh new beat for you to get on with. 2006.
Oh, that's a good one.
That was very popular in the old boys. Get on it.
Why does it make me laugh? Lloyd pretending to edit as we go. It's really got me today.
You know, it'd be really funny if you just cut out all of the keep that ins, but not the actual things, just where he says it. Yeah. And at the end, just keep. All right, lads, loving the pod. Can you please have a serious word with our mate, Charlie? He seems to be enjoying getting bent over and shafted by his boss because he works like a dog for shit pay. Most people wouldn't even get out of bed for. With the little money he has, he spends it on horrific tattoos you'd expect to find in a kid's sticker book, and it's only getting worse.
Fucking hell.
One of his new designs is a prison tattoo, and we're sure he's never even walked past one, never mind being in one. He likes to show off his new ink at his local pub, where he often ends the night hanging out the back of a sea creature. Jesus Christ. Next to a table full of Mozambique. Lloyd got a smile back.
Fucking sea creature.
We decided to take him to Bali on a lad's holiday to have a word, but instead, after a few games of STI bingo, he ended up with another awful tattoo across his leg saying, I came to Bali to find myself. He likes to think of himself as a real rock and roller, but we feel he needs a two stretch to calm the flash fucker down. We're deeply concerned about our mate Charlie, but he won't listen to us. Please have a word, lads, from Aaron and Marty. So he's working for shit money. He's spending all his shit money on tattoos and he's a bit of a manslag.
Nothing wrong with that. Can't judge that, can we?
Any of it.
Nah. The manslag bit. We're not in any position to be like, it's disgusting, you need to find someone and settle down.
Jackus!
But in terms of the tattoos, it's a difficult one because they're done, aren't they? The tattoos
You're
are
You're well
on.
More of a slag than I am. Or what? You were more of a slag than I am.
I was a bit of a dirty boy back in the days.
As long as he's happy. Like, and he's getting his tattoos and he's enjoying his tattoos. He might regret them later on down the line, but that's what laser surgery is for. He's just going to have to work double shifts in order to pay for it.
You can't laser surgery your whole body, though, can you?
I'm sure it's possible. It'll just take ages.
You're just going to look like Deadpool.
Yeah, but that's fine, though, isn't it?
No, you can laser surgery off, like, I love, you know, Darren. Yeah. And then you've got a bit of a weird bit of skin. But if you've had him everywhere, he's gone. You're right.
It's a long drive in a Range Rover.
How lucky would it be, though, if you got an I Love Darren and Darren fucked off and you met another Darren?
What are you looking for? What are you looking for, Sophie? I just want, you know, specifically a Darren.
Yeah.
But when would you show him the tattoo?
About 6 years
three,
in.
No, three or four weeks in, go, look, I know this is a bit keen, but there you go. Oh, it's faded quite a lot.
Yeah, it's actually the style of it. I'm not...
I'm one R, not two. Oh, shit.
Tattoos were done well are super fucking cool. Some girls with tattoos, it's so sexy. And yeah. When it's got wrong, it's like, oh, it's just a shit top you can't take off. Isn't it? It's like, you know when someone buys bad clobber and you're like, oh, someone spent some money on a fucking clothes shop and shouldn't have. But tattoos are forever.
But it's like they get used to it, and then they like, no, I've not got any tattoos. Like I'm not
do
really.
Like a sexy tattoo on a girl, though.
Do you? Where do you like it?
Arms. Anywhere.
Foot, arms.
Leg.
Yeah.
Oh, he loves a thigh tattoo. Yeah.
Do you love a thigh tattoo?
A side
no,
one.
He does.
Oh, no, he does specifically. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, he loves
something
it.
On a hand as well.
No, just like a thigh, little foot. Side thing, no, maybe.
He's into.
The name of her seven
thigh.
Children.
Well, maybe you'll meet someone with face. A thigh tattoo. Face.
Like permanent face paint.
Yeah. Have you been in a Mexican prison? I think you'd fucking, you'd meet a really nice guy.
Have
there.
I told you I get like turned on by Halloween?
Oh, God.
Good Lord.
What? Don't act surprised, you know.
Who
this.
Are we having to have a
like
word?
Fancy dress.
Oh, fancy dress, yeah. Yeah.
You are not coming trick or treating with my 3-year-old. Tell you what, Zanetta's looking fucking great. Where did she get that witch's outfit? Look at her. Look at her.
Like,
right,
fancy dress.
Sexy pumpkin.
Does something for me. And like seeing a girl dressed as like a zombie with blood coming out of her and all that is just does something. So like permanent tattoo of that, I could live with that.
Well, a permanent tattoo of her being beaten up is basically what you're saying. This is awful,
not beaten
mate.
Beaten up. Murdered.
Oh yeah, that's fine, isn't it? Jesus Christ.
Old Faithful.
On Halloween, a few years back, went to my auntie works in a hospice in Grimsby, where I'm from, and there's a poster on the wall, and it was like Halloween party. I mean, Halloween party in a hospice. It was like, what? Not the time
they were having
Halloween
party
in
palliative care, and,
and I was like,
it's just the patient.
Seems a bit insensitive given the situation. Yeah. But they said, Halloween fancy dress, prizes for best dressed, rules. I was like, what I love more than a Halloween party is a Halloween party in a hospice. What I love more than a Halloween party in a hospice, a Halloween party in a hospice with rules. I was and it's like, no. And it said, ghosts, zombies, gravestones.
Oh, God.
And then the one underneath it, there was a few others that I was like, okay. And then this is not, I've tried doing this as material and it's not funny. But he's just so mad. The last one said, cats. I said to my auntie, like, why are you allowed to dress up as a cat? She went, you know what? I thought I was weird. And I asked one of the girls that works here, apparently, it's because cats have 9 lives and they don't want to rub it in. I was like, fuck off. No one's looking at that and going, oh, we can't. No, because cats have 9 lives, don't they? And like, we've only got one. I was like, are you being serious? So someone would put that on there
what
going.
Are they allowed to dress up? That's what they all just dogs.
That's fine.
I think it's just been pumpkins. Or
pumpkins
like,
and superheroes.
That hospice in Grimsby needs to lean into fucking Christmas and Easter
it's
a bit
actually,
more.
It was just outside of Grimsby as well. I just changed it because they wanted to know who they were. But
oh, my God. My ears are sore. This has been such a good one.
So much fun. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks. Is that it?
Yeah.
Am I done?
That's the pod.
Great. Can I have a wee?
Oh, have a word?
Sort of.
He's living his best life. Let him do
you
it.
Can't, he's live got, he's your covered life, in tattoos.
Be free.
He's done the damage.
You know you can have it all.
Have sex with whoever you want, dressed as whoever you are, with whatever it is on your body, and just your
fuck
mates
your boss
your
off.
Your mates are dicks, okay?
Oh, mate, I've had a fun one.
It's been good. Have you got anything to plug?
What?
You got anything to plug?
During a global pandemic, mate. Nah, not really.
No, have you not got a podcast or a YouTube channel or...
Yeah, I've got all that, but it's doing all right, mate. I'm joking. Please. If you like football and shit impressions, a.k.a. Adam, then I've got a YouTube...
We can't have the same face and the same content.
I've got a YouTube channel called Premier League Fan Reactions on Lloyd Griffith comedian thing. I guess it's actually the views this year. I've only done 3. The views have been shit compared to what I usually get.
Oh,
yeah,
go.
There's a lot of stuff been knocked out. That's why everyone's at home going, fuck, I've got to make
this. This is going to dwarf our stuff. What are you getting on average at the
48,000.
Oh, no.
We don't need to know.
About 90,000.
All right, yeah, cool. Unlucky, mate.
Yeah, but
well, enjoy our extra
I'd get 150 to 300,000 views, but it's not really been having.
Could you cut that out?
I'm on tour next year, hopefully.
Maybe.
LloydGriffith.com. Everywhere apart from Liverpool, because they never sell there, so there's no point putting a fucking...
And if we go to a UFC event next year, will you come up? Will you come up with
UFC.
It? All right, boxing.
Yeah,
if we
definitely.
Go, if we go on, if we get fucking, we'll do a have a word thing. We'll film.
Yeah, if we put one on, the
that
have
seems
a word
like
presents.
A lot of hassle.
Can we do the festival first before you try and knock me out?
Can we one of the nights?
I don't want to get punched by you.
We don't have to fight. We'll just get other people to do it.
All right. Okay.
If there's like a thing at MEN or Liverpool, let's.
Would you come up?
Yeah, defo. Yeah, I love boxing.
I'll see you there. Right. Well, that's been an absolute pleasure. Have we got anything to plug? Follow. Keep your eye out on social media because we might be doing something.
We're going to do a protest.
Maybe.
As you all know. haveawaypod@gmail.com. And what was the thing they have to send us?
Papa
wants some charcoal.
Oh, yeah. Can you follow me on Instagram and Twitter at Lloyd Griffith? Thank you.
Please do that. Support all our guests.
Been a pleasure.
Support
thanks,
our
Lloyd.
Sponsors.
Really appreciate you coming up. Have a great weekend in Blackpool.
Who do I invoice?
Hey!
For this, invoice Carl. He'll sort that out for you. Like the video, please. Subscribe. Ring the bell. And patreon.com/haveawaypod. You'll get early access to these public episodes and you get an extra episode every single week and some really interesting bonus content as well every now and then whenever we can be asked. Bye, Felicia.
Bye, Felicia.